Memorial Field in College Station, Texas, as the Aggies prepare to play host to the Miami Hurricanes of the Atlantic Coast Conference. Welcome to College Football, presented by Best Buy. Today, it's the Miami Hurricanes of the ACC visiting Kyle Field, home of the Texas A&M Aggies of the Big 12. Hi, everybody. Ron Franklin, and welcome to College Station. You know, just 8 days ago, the coast of southeastern Texas was devastated as Hurricane Ike came ashore, making landfall first at Galveston and then into the Houston Ship Channel, taking with it Bolivar Peninsula, Kima, small communities that simply gobbled up as it went on in to East Texas. Millions of Texans have been displaced. They had to be evacuated because of this massive storm. Yesterday, we learned from Houston Power and Light that they were putting 1 million more people on the grid yesterday. It may not seem like a large thing, but in a state that has suffered so much really pain and suffering within the last 8 days, it maybe is just a small thread of normalcy that people can maybe watch a college football game and get their mind off the destruction that happened 8 days ago. We certainly hope so. Ed Cunningham joins me on the telecast as usual, and an injury is going to mark who the starting quarterback is for the Texas Aggies today, Ed.
Yeah, it was going back and forth all week, Ron, and who would start. And, of course, Stephen McGee, the senior, hurt his shoulder against New Mexico. He will not start. Gerard Johnson will get his first start as an Aggie. And when we met with him yesterday, he seems like he's up to the task. A very bright young man who knows his entire offense. McGee, I doubt we're going to see him today, but we will see the entire offense with Johnson in there. He's a fine athlete.
Well, the Aggies are not the only team that have problems with injury. Javaris James had been the number one tailback for the Miami Hurricanes. High ankle sprain. We won't see him at all today.
Yeah, not sure when they're going to see him again. A couple of weeks at least. And the problem is James was their inside runner. Of course, Greg Cooper burst on the scene last year, had a great game against Texas A&M in a game that they wore out to a 31-0 lead. He's got to establish some type of inside run because he's going to be the main back until they get James back.
We're at the home of the 12th man, one of the most unique college football settings in the nation. We'll have the kickoff from Kyle Field when we come back. You're watching ESPN on ABC. South Tunnel, here come the Texas A&M Fighting Aggies. And as we go to a wide shot of the stadium in a bit, you'll say, is the stadium moving? Well, that happens when the team takes the field here in Aggieland, home of the 12th man, where tradition is absolutely paramount. Miami has in store two freshman quarterbacks. That's what A&M has to settle today. Let's go down to the sideline. Jack Arute has more on that.
Yeah, Kyle Wright and Kirby Freeman know exactly what it's like to flip-flop back and forth on quarterbacks, and they did it last year, create a lot of dissension. So what did Jacoby Harris and Robert Marv do? As quarterbacks that have shared the starting role, they decided they were going to make sure there was no dissension this year. They've become friends on the field, in the locker room, in the field, in the film room, and also outside in socializing. They said it's our role to make sure we don't have that type of dissension anymore. They said, in fact, we don't care who starts. The other one is going to watch and make sure he's got the other guy's back. That's just one of the things that changed, guys, for this year's Miami Hurricanes.
Okay, Jack Arute, and we look at the head coach in his second year, Randy Shannon. He knows no other university, really, at Cunningham. He played, he was a graduate assistant, has been an assistant coach, and now is head coach for Miami.
And brought in Bill Young, the defensive coordinator from Kansas, has totally turned over the defense to him, and I think it was a great change by Randy Shannon in his second year.
So many coaches are doing that very thing, no coordinating position. Mike Sherman came in from the Houston Texans. He had been in Aggieland before as an offensive line coach and had been on the staff. But now he is here as the head coach, and he brought a brand new staff with him, and we'll document those gentlemen as the afternoon goes on. Bosher to kick it off for Miami. And I mentioned the weather conditions. a very high sky, a little bit hazy, but bright sun. And in fact, it may get a little warm as this afternoon progresses. Temperatures they're talking about to reach into the mid to upper 80s. Gray, along with Stevens, the two deep men for the Texas Aggies. Two teams with a lot of youth and a lot to prove. Short kick on the run from the 13 is Gray. Gray, near sideline, breaks a tackle. 35-40. And the Aggies will scrimmage with outstanding field position at their own 43-yard line. Well, the starting quarterback for this afternoon, as we watch Gerard Johnson coming on the field for the Texas Aggies. Keep an eye on the scroll at the top of your screen, and you'll see all 11 starters for Texas A&M.
Johnson, who committed to Texas A&M as a sophomore in high school, replacing Stephen McGee, came first as a basketball recruit and has now dedicated himself completely to quarterback, although he was playing wide receiver against New Mexico two Saturdays ago.
Jaworski Lane, the fullback, offset to the right. Gibson is the tailback, and we have a flag on the very first play.
Now, it looked like Kevin Matthews, the center, is going to get five for flinching.
Prior to the snap, false start. Offense, number 74. Five-yard penalty, remains first down.
Check that. That's Lee Grimes. Looked like everybody in the middle moved a bit for A&M.
So everybody gets pumped up, crowd on their feet, coaches are excited, players are excited, and a couple a little too excited. Yeah, and so all of a sudden now we're going to take a step back,
breathe,
a deep breath,
yep,
and do it all over again. It'll be first down and 15 from the 38. Cyrus Gray comes into the ballgame at tailback, and he will be the lone setback along with quarterback Gerard Johnson. They wanted to throw to him, but they throw the middle screen back to the other side, and it's Goodson who was flanked out wide there, and he's loose. 50, 45, 40, near sideline, he may go. 15, 10, 5, touchdown, A&M, 62 yards. The first play, the coaching staff was not wild about because they got a five-yard penalty. The real first play, they're in love with right now. Extra point attempt to come. Bean, ball is down, and the kick is up, and he's good. And I mean, this crowd is up and electric.
Well, they didn't like the first game against Arkansas State, which was a shocking loss. But one guy that they are going to use a ton is the outside receiver. As we go ahead and roll this, that's Mike Goodson. You had mentioned that Gray was in at running back. Well, this is something we saw in practice the other day. Goodson, a young man, whenever you're around the Big 12, other defensive coaches talk about, this is the guy who scares us, and Mike Sherman and his staff now putting in stuff to take advantage of this guy's speed.
And Ed, as you watch him in isolation, watch the pursuit angle by two different defenders is wrong, but he is that quick.
Well, and he's one of those guys who runs so smoothly. He doesn't look like he's running fast because it's so effortless, and I think that's a guy like Goodson in that speed. Sometimes, until the game comes, there's no way you can tell how fast he really is.
Mike Goodson, many people would argue, but this includes every tailback in the Big 12 Conference. He's in that category, and he doesn't really take a backseat to any of them, do you think?
No, and added almost 20 pounds during the offseason, knowing when they moved Jaworski Lane to fullback full-time, although we may see him in some one-back, that he was going to be the guy. And that was really some of the issues the fans had with the offense that was run under the previous staff, was not using number three enough.
Well, number 27, Bean, he's been an active guy, and he will kick this one off. Back deep, Harris and Hill for Miami. 3 yards deep, they'll return it. This is Harris. Harris got a blocker in front, and now he's loose, and he'll bring it a nice return out across the 40-yard line. That's 41 yards on the return. Robert Marv, the starting quarterback for Miami today. And again, keep an eye on the very top. There it is, the scroll for the starting 11 for the Hurricanes on offense.
Well, how about the beginning of a career? Suspended first game, he had an off-field incident, was suspended against Coastal Carolina. And then second start last week, or 2 weeks ago, excuse me, at the Swamp. Now Kyle Field, Patrick Nix, the offensive coordinator, quote, he doesn't get big eyes, we'll be fine.
Cooper, the lone tailback. Aggies come with a blitz. First down, lobs it over the middle, has a man open at the 30-yard line, and he's got to complete for a big gainer all the way. Let's see, it's going to be 29 yards on the pass play. And it'll be a first and 10 for Miami at the 30. And that is Farquharson.
He's a senior and not even expected to play. The coaches didn't even bring up his name in our meetings.
Not on the depth chart, and
no.
That is 1, 2, or 3. So maybe part of the tricks of the head coach, but it worked beautifully. Counter Trey up the middle, big opening, has 5, counted off at 7, and Cooper will be stopped. Let's take a look at the Miami impact players. This is brought to you by Best Buy.
Well, we mentioned right at the top, Javaris James out. We're not sure how long, so Greg, don't call me Craig, Cooper gets the start. Nice start with that run. Sam Shields, a guy who the coaches are expecting to stand up as a junior. They need some veteran leadership out there. And then up front, Jason Fox from Fort Worth, Texas, has started every game at tackle, and the coach's son, Xavier Shannon, starts at center, the fifth-year senior who transferred from Florida International.
And if you're saying it's Xavier, no, it's not. Family prefers him to be called Xavier. Quick out pass, sideline. That should be close to the first down. As LaRon Bird, a freshman out of Boutte, Louisiana, that's down in the New Orleans area, is there to make the reception. We've seen a number of kids over the years from Boutte that played at LSU.
And they were shocked that they were able to get him. LSU went very hard after Bird, but Randy Shannon has established himself in his 2 years as head coach on that Pete Carroll level. He truly is a masterful recruiter.
Well, the kid also said he had grew up being a fan of Miami, and he decided that's where he wanted to go. They moved the chain, so it's a first down. They're at the Aggie 19-yard line. But keep it on the ground. Running play, they bounce it out, has 5, has 10, cuts it back. It's Cooper at the 5, and he will score. 19 yards on the running play. You know, you think both offensive coaches have been hammering away at some kids, because in this ball game, everybody thought defense way ahead of offense, and so far to this looked just the opposite.
With all the youth, A&M, of course, starting a quarterback for the first time today. They have youth at receiver, Miami youth at receiver. Cooper, who burst onto the scene last year as a freshman, it's making people forget Javaris James is injured.
Bosher with the extra point attempt. And he's got it. And as we go to break, let's take one more look. It's a 19-yard run by the sophomore out of Memphis Melrose High School, Greg Cooper. We're tied at 7.
Introducing the all-new Dodge Journey with the most innovative features. Third row seating. DVD player and gaming outlet. 5-star crash test rating. And the best fuel economy in its class. It's the crossover that's ready for anything. The all-new Dodge Journey. If you can dream it, do it.
All right. Who ate my volcano taco?
Don't look at me.
Introducing Taco Bell's new 89-cent Volcano Taco. With spicy lava sauce, it could be the spiciest taco ever.
Oh, was me.
Why pay more for heat when you can think outside the bun?
See, I've been spending a lot of time doing that.
Alex!
You know?
Oh, no. Alex!
Whoa, what's up with your dad?
Son.
Since we got Rap City on Verizon Wireless, I get all my favorite music.
Over
Unfortunately,
here.
My dad gets his favorite
Alexander
still.
Alexander Garrett, why won't you answer your dad?
So does my mom.
That was weird at that age, too.
Rhapsody on Verizon Wireless. Access to millions of songs, and you get them all for one flat rate. Enjoy them on a touchscreen Samsung Glide for $79.99. Verizon Wireless.
Warren Sapp spent his career pressuring the quarterback. every football player that's done the shot has either won or been second.
And you gonna put that on me?
Who's feeling the heat now, Warren? Dancing with the Stars live premieres Monday, 8, 7 Central on ABC.
There are moments that make us believe anything is possible. If only these moments could last.
I'm carrying your child.
Thursday, Grey's Anatomy is back.
Watch out!
Oh, God.
How bad is it?
You're sleeping with him?
I'm done.
We are saving this man.
No!
Nominated for 5 Emmys, ABC's Grey's Anatomy 2-hour season premiere, Thursday at 9, 8 Central, part of National Stay at Home Week on ABC.
So both coaches pacing the sidelines. At least we're not going to have a 3-2. 7-7 in the first 2 minutes and 4 seconds. Listen to this, the game summary, if you've just joined us. We've had 5 snaps, 121 combined yards, and 2 touchdowns.
Well, we all talked about how this felt like it was going to be a defensive game. Probably not like Auburn, Mississippi State last week, but I have to say a little shocked at how this game has begun.
Basha moves forward, gets a foot into this one, and it's returnable near sideline at the 5-yard. He stepped out of bounds at the 4.5-yard line, Cyrus Gray. And because it was so close to the sideline, that is a great job by Basher. He forced it.
Well, and it's a freshman mistake. The angle of the kick looked like it may have gone out of bounds. Worst case, it goes in the end zone. It's a touchback. And Gray, a true freshman, needs to know where he is. But that's what you're going to battle. Both of these teams are going to play a ton of true and second-year redshirt freshmen. And you're going to get those types of things.
So Gerard Johnson, who opened at quarterback and has a touchdown pass on his very first play of being a starter here at Texas A&M, is now settled in from his own 4.5-yard line. Keandre Smith is a tailback. They give it to him, spins off a tackle, trying to maintain his balance, and he'll take it out to the 12-yard line. Here's a look at the impact players brought to you by Best Buy for Texas A&M.
Well, the first one's obvious. We already know what Mike Goodson could do, and now the coaches from A&M stole my thunder. I had a hunch that Keandre Smith would be a big part of this game as a Miami player is down, but Smith, a tough inside runner, nice complement to Goodson's speed. And Kevin Matthews, first-year starter at center, very key because of the defense that Bill Young, the new defensive coordinator, brings, all of those blitzes. He's got to get them headed in the right direction.
Reddick is the man who was shaken up. We'll get more on him. Yeah, Matthews, what great bloodlines. His father Bruce played with both the Houston Oilers and also with the Titans, and his uncle played forever with Cleveland. I think what 18 or 19 years a linebacker.
Yeah, played long enough that I actually had to block him a couple of times.
Second down, we're caught at about 4. Short pass, got it out in the flat, complete to Fuller, and that'll be enough for the A&M first down. Defensively, Glenn Cook, a senior out of Hollywood, Florida, the middle linebacker, makes the tackle.
Being the big first national impact game for A&M, the coaching staff put together by Mike Sherman. Of course, you mentioned he came over from Houston, Texas, longtime head coach of the Green Bay Packers, hired Nolan Cromwell, who we'll discuss as his offensive coordinator. Of course, was a great defensive back in the NFL. He's now the offensive coordinator here for Texas A&M.
Keandre Smith gets the handoff and will maybe have a gain of 1. Here are the Miami impact players.
Well, with all the youth, Miami does have some veteran guys. One of them, Glenn Cook, actually his 6th year was granted that. They need him at that linebacker spot to settle down a young defensive line. And a young man, true freshman, Sean Spence, nicknamed the Eraser. You're going to see why today. A sensational player. And Anthony Reddick, another senior, just carted off. They need him in the secondary. They had some mental busts against Florida. 1 cost them a touchdown.
Lane back in the lineup along with Goodson. Goodson will get the handoff. Nothing to the left. Spins around. Flag is down, but he's going to be tackled for a loss. And that is that quick pursuit by really good athletes on this Miami defense.
Yesterday when we popped in the coach's film of Miami's defense against Florida, and you get a little better view with the coach's film than you do on the TV copy.
Offside. Defense number 91. 5 yards from the previous spot.
Joe Joseph, the junior out of Orlando, Florida, is the man who was offsides. Randy Shannon on the sideline saying, young man, I know how badly you want to get across that line of scrimmage, but you cost us about 9 yards there because we had thrown him for a loss, and it would have been a third down situation in very long.
Randy Shannon knows all about speed at Miami. Of course, was a linebacker, won a national championship, defensive coordinator, won a national championship, and that's what those teams were built on, was that speed we're talking about.
Miami shows blitz, and they hand it off to Goodson, and because of the penetration, Jaborski Lane came up and took the blitzing linebacker, but then there was nobody to get the wave behind him.
Well, and when we watched, again, going back to that coach's film, we watched of Miami's game at Florida. We saw that Bill Young, the first-year defensive coordinator, ton of experience, been all over the country as a defensive coordinator, likes to bring pressure on every down, including running downs. That was a run down, second and short. Pressure comes and gets a loss.
Bad news for the Aggies, and we'll keep an eye. Their most experienced offensive lineman, Travis Snyder, the right tackle, number 75, had just limped off the field. Draw play. Gray, not much doing there. So on third down and short, it's going to be third down and five, and the Aggies will have to punt for the first time this afternoon. Now, when they have to punt, they have a young guy by the name of Justin Brantley, who played his high school football at Seeley High School, a really good high school football program they have had forever down at Seeley. He is averaging 45.8 per punt. Fire the deep man for Miami. And this is not his best. It's a low line drive. Collier from the 31. Collier to the 39. 46 on the punt and 8 on the return. We'll be right back. We're tied at 7.
ESPN College Football on ABC. Brought to you by Best Buy. You happier. Chrysler. The way our vehicles come together is what sets us apart. Chrysler. And Taco Bell. Think outside the bun.
Well, you see the fans at the full force behind the Miami bench there. We were talking about Brantley, the punter, being from Seeley, Texas. And he averaged almost 46 yards a punt in the first two ball games. That other one was a line drive, but it still went 46. An extremely strong leg. Marv, far sideline, has it complete at the 50 for a first down, and that is Sam Shields on the receiving end. So Miami, a great job as far as Marv is concerned, a field position, his own 41 the first time, Ed, his own 38 this time.
And it's very obvious that Patrick Nix, the offensive coordinator, they had an extra week, just like Texas A&M did coming in, is starting to take off the wraps a little bit on this offense. He'd been catching some heat for being conservative, but said, look, I can't hurt these guys' psyche. I have to call a conservative game. And right now, it's far from that, letting him throw the ball down the field.
Straight ahead with the running game. Big opening, 5, 10, 15. This is Cooper. He's going to the house. 10, 5, touchdown, Miami. And that is 51 yards on the running play. I think the wraps have come off. I'm not sure.
Yeah, to me, it looked like A&M had confusion. Well, those are the ones you call as an offense coordinator and hope to get about 5 yards, not a touchdown. But it looked like A&M had a little confusion lining up and left a huge gaping hole at the snap on the right side of Miami's offensive line, and that's right where he ran through.
Joe Kimes, the new offense or new defensive coordinator for the Aggies, will gather his troops when they come to the sideline to talk that one over as Bosher knocks home the extra point. It take us to the break of the touchdown.
Well, we talked about at the top, Javaris James out, and could Cooper run between the tackles? I think he just answered that question.
Today's AT&T All-America flashback, Lorenzo White. As a sophomore in 1985, he led the nation in rushing with over 1,900 yards.
As a senior in 1987, White led the Spartans to their first Rose Bowl appearance since 1966 by rushing for over 1,500 yards. Text VOTE to 51234 now on your AT&T wireless phone to play All-America Trivia for a chance to win a trip to the national championship game.
Let's talk merger.
Beep. Ned's phone. Ned doesn't have AT&T, which means no bars here in Finland. So when Ned's boss called to say not to mention the merger, Ned, don't hint at the merger, Ned, don't even think about the word merger, Ned, it isn't finalized and everyone will freak out. We didn't get that call.
For the best coverage, switch to AT&T. More bars in more places. Now get our exclusive Sony Ericsson W350 for only $29.99.
It's time saving energy costs less. It's time guaranteed low prices got even lower. We know times are tough. That's why the Home Depot is lowering the cost on hundreds of items throughout the store, including energy-efficient ones like ceiling fans and programmable thermostats. So the products that save you the most money will save you even more. The Home Depot. You can do it. We can help.
Game day.
Yeah, lucky breakfast.
Bergwood, your new car's rolling.
It's not stolen, I just bought it.
It's gonna hit that truck.
There's no need to swear.
Oh. Hot car, huh?
It's on fire.
Do you have new car replacement? Call Allstate to sign up today. Are you in good hands?
Jimmy Kimmel's Big Night of Stars, Sunday at 7, 6 Central on ABC.
You're watching ESPN College Football on ABC, presented by Best Buy.
Back here at College Station, the Miami Hurricanes have gone up by 7. That man, Greg Cooper, accounts for the difference. Guys, Cooper likes to tell the story about the fact that he went on a recruiting visit to Tennessee. Philip Fulmer says, hey, nice to meet you, Craig. He said, no, coach, it's Greg with a G. He said, hello, Mr. Cooper, his dad. He goes, no, coach, my dad's name is Tino. And, well, one thing Randy Shannon knew, how to say Cooper and Greg instead of Craig.
And he's in Miami. That's right. Gray on the return. He will be stopped before the 20-yard line. Now, one of the things is apparent. They're on the road. But the comfort level for the Miami Hurricanes has grown on every snap of the football, be it offense, defense, or special teams.
This is the second year in a row that we've been got to cover a Randy Shannon coach team. Now, last year, third game of the season, they went to Oklahoma and just got blasted. And you get the sense that Randy Shannon's toughness and confidence and his connection to the players, knowing players' names, things of that nature, are starting to pay off. This is a much different team than we saw in Norman last year this time.
Well, from the shotgun, running play back into the boundary, and that is Mike Pitson. Mike will be stopped at around the 24-yard line.
Goodson.
Gray actually took the direct snap. I kept looking, thinking, you know, Gerard Johnson is not that short.
Yeah, and Gray was a quarterback, although he played running back in high school most of the time at DeSoto High School and DeSoto, Texas, but he did play quarterback as a senior, so he's used to taking that direct snap and running with it.
Well, this time Jaworski Lane comes back into the football game at fullback. He is offset to the left at the 20. They fake a counter tray, got a man open, and waited too long. He had his receiver open, but because he waited, Terrence McCoy was gained on defensively by the quarterback, Bruce Johnson, and Bruce almost made a pickoff.
Yeah, and that's something that Tom Rossley, the quarterback coach for Texas A&M, who also comes over from the NFL, will have to work with Gerard Johnson on. When you're playing a team with the speed of Miami, and they're going to see it, teams like Oklahoma that are on the schedule, you can't look, wait, and then throw. You've got to see it and throw. So those are some of the things making a first start that they'll have to work out with Mr. Johnson.
Mike Goodson is the man split out wide to the top of your screen. Quick pass. It is caught at the 38. Tackle is broken. And that's McCoy. And Jamie McCoy will take it across midfield to the 49-yard line. Good for 27.
And
McCoy walked away from his usual tight end spot. He was just converted to wide receiver, of course. Martellus Bennett now with the Dallas Cowboys, so they were looking for a playmaker at that position. And McCoy, although still mostly built like a wide receiver, doing a good job. And he got hit right when he caught that. Nice hands.
Well, he was a wide receiver, as you said, and they use him a lot in motion, and they'll stop him on one side or the other for blocking purposes. That time he continued to move. Keander Smith at tailback this time as the Aggies continue to move those running backs around. Pressure is on. Just going to throw this one away is Jerod Johnson. If you had just joined us, Jerod Johnson starting in this ball game today. Stephen McGee, who injured a shoulder 2 weeks ago against New Mexico. Shoulder still very slow. There is quite a bit of competition between these two. And as Johnson pushes, he's getting an opportunity to start in this ball game. As you look at Coach Rosley, the former head coach at SMU. Our scoring, first play for the Aggies, 62-yard pass play to Gibson, and then Cooper with a 19 and a 15, 51-yard run. So a 51-yard run and a 19-yard run by Cooper, and that's how we stand as Goodson is going to take the ball to the Miami 42.
Another direct snap. They're trying to show a bunch of different looks. They had the bye week, so you're starting to see a lot more offense being put in by Nolan Cromwell. We've mentioned Tom Rosley, and let's not forget that Mike Sherman was an offensive coordinator at the NFL level. So there's three guys who have called plays. Rosley was Green Bay's offensive coordinator from 2000 to 2006. There is a lot of smarts on this offensive staff.
Jerod Johnson back in the stand-up position behind the center. Blitz coming right up the middle. And he takes off with it, and he's going to wind up with the first down at the 38-yard line as Colin McCarthy will make the tackle.
One of the things that Mike Sherman and his staff had to work on, of course, Dennis Franchione was let go right after the big win right here against Texas last year, and the players liked and respected Dennis Franchione, was to get the players to buy into this new system. And talking to Jerod Johnson, he said when these coaches came in, Mike Sherman and his staff, they put in a tape to say, look, this is the offense we're going to run. And we looked and we saw that it was Brett Favre and the Green Bay Packers showing us how to run this offense. It was pretty easy to buy in at that point that these guys knew what they were doing.
Johnson, pass in the flat, flag comes down deep. Incomplete, but let's see what the call is going to be. Offensive pass interference as it goes against the Texas Aggies. Ed's been talking about the NFL experience on this staff brought by Coach Sherman.
And pass interference, offense number 83, 15 yards from the previous spot. It remains first down.
Terrence McCoy is the guilty party, and we'll just take you to the scoreboard and say, figure it up for yourself.
Last night when I was looking through our notes and saw how many guys had spent a lot of time. Nolan Cromwell, 17 years, pretty much right when he got done playing, began as a special teams coach and on the defensive side, but along the way became a wide receivers coach. And that's when he started thinking about, I'd like to be an offensive coordinator, and has worked his way up to being that his first year in college for Cromwell.
Short yardage. Boy, you can hear the contact all the way up here. You could also hear it on our field microphone as Miami makes the tackle. Ojomo, Adewale Ojomo, is the man who made the tackle. He had a really good ball game. We watched video yesterday for about 2.5 hours against a good Florida team, and he was all over.
It was really impressive to watch Miami's defense against what I think all of us can agree is maybe the best balanced offense in college football. And they went toe-to-toe for three quarters with them, and it was 9-3 after three quarters, Florida. And then they took it away a little bit in that field.
Second down and 22. Johnson got it complete. That's Fuller. Fuller turns it up, and he'll be about 10 yards shy of the first down. The NASCAR Sprint Cup Series at Dover, presented by Principal Financial Group on ABC, and that is tomorrow. Coverage begins with NASCAR Countdown, 1 o'clock Eastern.
And now you're in a position with Jerod Johnson. Stephen McGee has an NFL arm. The coaches here have said the scouts have really taken a liking to McGee, and I think one of the reasons he's not
playing is because they don't want to get him hurt for the rest of this year. The offensive line struggling. So now let's see what they can do with Johnson, who doesn't quite have the arm of McGee.
Ninth play of the drive. It all started back at the 19-yard line. They're going to take it to the 28 for the first down. It's a quarterback draw. Has 5, has 10, counted off at 15, and a first down Aggies at the 21-yard line as Bruce Johnson makes the save. Officially, they're saying a 17-yard gain.
And now we see what the plan is going to be with Jerod Johnson in a passing situation. Miami comes out in a three-man line. They blitzed off of the right side of the formation. But because they know that the strength of Johnson is running with the ball in his hands, that's what they call. And they ran away from where Miami looked like they were coming for a blitz. So that was a nice call by the staff of Texas A&M.
4 wide receivers set for A&M. And they also have a man in the backfield. Blitz is on, pressure, and that's going to be grounding. Nope, he did have a man in the mm-hmm. vicinity. Now, the Miami coaches not agree.
Yeah, it's Keandre Smith, and he's caught in the wash, so I don't think that the Miami coaches saw him. Nice heads-up play by Jerod Johnson. And a heads-up that our telestrator, where we normally circle people to show you, is on the fritz, so I won't be able to circle where Keandre is.
That's Sharpton right there who will come in. And, well, he's very fortunate that he had a player right mm-hmm. there, because the referee who is behind the play was reaching for his flag.
Wisely saw, though, that Smith was in there, so he didn't call it.
Miami shows blitz again. Here they come. Pass incomplete, thrown a little too quickly. Jeff Fuller, but he had to get rid of it because the pressure was coming. Now, defensively, we're seeing more from Miami as they did against Florida, which was literally send somebody on every play.
Well, you said when we met with the coaches yesterday, it looks like Miami gets off the bus blitzing. And Bill Young, who did a masterful job at Kansas, where you're not able to get the best athletes, and made the choice when he got the call from Randy Shannon to go work with a bunch of studs. And that's what Miami is accumulating on that side of the ball. This is starting to look like Miami's defense of the late 80s, early 90s.
Third down. They need to take it to the 12. Here comes pressure. Hit as he throws. Corner of the end zone that is overthrown and incomplete. And actually, I know there was contact, but it was very good position as Atkins was coming with pressure, but the quarterback just sealed him. And when he went out of bounds, nothing he could do.
And right now, Johnson's struggling with pressure. He's having a hard time feeling where he needs to move to. He tends to start falling backwards, and he's trying to make long throws. He needs to start sidestepping that pressure so he can step into the throw.
And this is going to be a 38-yard field goal attempt. Richie Beam got it. 38. That's a season long for him.
And the fans are very happy. That Arkansas State loss here on the home field was all about turnovers and 2 missed field goals. They end up losing that game 18-14, and the fans in front of us, they raise their hands like, thank you, now we're back to normal here.
Because the coaches did say yesterday, if we have more problems, if it is persistent, then we're going to have to look elsewhere, because we don't have time losing ball games by field goals.
No, and I respect the coaches, though. They didn't put it all on Richie Beam. There was some snap and holding issues in that Arkansas State game. Of course, the bye week, they were able to work through that, and being a senior who's waited his turn, they didn't pull the rug out from underneath it. They want the seniors along for the ride with this transition, and they've worked very hard with guys like Richie Beam to keep them a part of the process.
Well, here's a flashback in last year's ball game. Miami crushed Texas A&M in this one, 34-17 down at the Orange Bowl. Quarterback Kyle Wright threw for 275 yards, 2 touchdowns. By the way, Miami at a time had a 31-0 lead in that ball game.
And that was where the downfall of the Dennis Franchione era started. That was a nationally televised game. It was embarrassing. And then, of course, the next week, people find out that there was a paid email service that talked about injuries and strategy and things of that nature. And really, that game, I think, the beginning of the end, and why Mike Sherman is now the head coach for the Aggies.
Beam to kick it off. Benjamin, who is a real speed burner, one of the deep men back, and he's going to get the kickoff. 1 yard deep, Travis Benjamin. And Benjamin met with a good hard tackle at around the 24-yard line. Matt Weiner, let's check with you back in New York.
Thanks. It's great to see you. I'll be here throughout your game to give you the very latest from the day's most important games around the country,
including Florida and Tennessee. In this Taco Bell update, this game always has a lot to say about the SEC East. This is Brandon James. Set up the Gators' first touchdown with a big kick return. This is a 78-yard punt return. All Florida so far, 17-0 at Neyland.
Okay, Matt, our situation, 14-10, Miami over Texas A&M, and this pass thrown right on the money at the 35 to Aldarius Johnson. Jack Arute, let's check in with you again.
Well, guys, you were talking about Patrick Nix being criticized for conservative play calling in the first couple of games. I chatted for about 20 minutes with him before the start of this game, and we talked a little bit about what he wanted to accomplish. He said, Jack, got to bring, as Ed talked about, bring my quarterback and my wide receivers together. But what I've noticed so far is on the sidelines, because he's down, he is working with both the receivers and the quarterback. What did you see? How are you doing this? He's coaching them up, and he's opened things up just a little bit.
Aggies show blitz off the corner. They throw back the other direction. It's complete, but Johnson is tackled immediately by Arkeith Brown.
And the one thing that was interesting, talking to Patrick Nix, who came, of course, was offensive coordinator on Chan Gailey at Georgia Tech, quarterback from Auburn back in the day. He'd always been upstairs as an offensive coordinator. Jack is talking about coming down and coaching. He's got all young receivers, mostly young receivers, young quarterbacks. He wants to be able to work with them face-to-face, not from the phone upstairs.
And here you can see it, three of them to the bottom of your screen. They'll go from the shotgun with one running back. Marr, that was a high pass. He handled it wonderfully. A flag goes down as the pass is incomplete. Aldarius Johnson, the intended receiver.
Well, they threw it where Leonard Hankerson was running a short route working against Jordan Pugh.
Ineligible receiver, number 82, offense was covered up and went downfield. The penalties declined. Brings up third down.
Well, that's Kane Farquharson, who covered up means that he was on the line of scrimmage and there was someone outside of him, so it's an illegal
also
formation.
On the line of scrimmage.
On the line of scrimmage, so he can't go down the field. That was a mental error by Miami.
Third down and 12. They need to take it to the 46-yard line. Crowd on their feet here at Texas A&M, making a lot of noise. Middle screen, he got blockers in front, and he breaks it. 40, 35, 30. I said there's a flag down, so we'll have to see. Is it going to be good, or is it going to be brought back? 66 yards on the pass play. Collier on the receiving end. It'll come back.
And another mental error. This happened before the snap, so Miami.
Illegal motion, number 85, offense. 5 yards from the previous spot, repeat third down.
Well, he's shaking his head. That's for the coach's benefit. But you see the movement, and yes, he moved early. So shake your head up and down, not to the side, because you were moving. And it cost your team a 66-yard touchdown.
Wow, and that was just a huge mental error by Leonard Hankerson. One of the rare sophomores, not quite an upperclassman, but so many freshmen out there, you don't expect that from a guy who's been in your program.
Third down, and still they have to take it up to the 46-yard line. See what Robert Marr comes up with here, the redshirt freshman out of Tampa, played at Plant High School. Miami leads it 14-10. Here comes pressure. Marv will be sacked as headgears go flying, and he is down back at the 25-yard line by Michael Bennett.
Bennett, a young man who was academically ineligible for last year's Alamo Bowl, did not play much during the spring. Obasor did a good job of forcing Marv into the pocket, but Bennett just now getting used to this new system because he had to get his academics in order through the spring, and the coach is very excited once Bennett gets the system down with his ability.
First punt of the afternoon by Miami. Jake Whiteclaw, freshman out of New Lenox, Illinois, punting. not real far off the side of his foot. Going to go out of bounds. And let's see, they're walking down the sideline now, but the officials will say, where's he going to stop?
Always the wait, yeah.
Yeah. Well, Tuesday this fall, ABC is bringing the game show to your house, literally. It's your life and your chance to win big. But the question is, how well do you know your family? Opportunity Knock, series premiere, Tuesday, and that's on ABC. 43-yard line is where they marked it. So a good starting field position for the Aggies, and they give it to Goodson. Nope, it is a keeper. Nice job by Jerrod Johnson. And Goodson went to the left, and Johnson is going to have a first down across midfield to the 47.
You know what's interesting is we showed all of that NFL experience. Well, the brain trust, Mike Sherman, Nolan Cromwell, and Tom Rosley, these are all NFL guys. And when Mike Sherman was a coach here for Texas A&M up until 96, this was not a part of the offense. So this staff had to come in and learn the spread option offense and quarterback keeper that's so popular in college football, and now using it to great effect.
Goodson bounces it outside. 40, pushed out of bounds at around the 37-yard line. Anthony Reddick defensively, and he is right on the yellow line, which would be still another A&M first down. Well, Goodson, and here's a snapshot of him. Too Good is his nickname. Why number three? Three times a charm. And favorite U.S. city, Houston, Texas, the best city in the world.
When he walked in yesterday for our sit-down chat, it took me a minute to realize that that was Mike Goodson. He is so much thicker than he was last year in his shoulders, his neck. He's put on 20 pounds of muscle.
There he goes again, this time for very short yardage. It'll be maybe one and a half, but that'll be just about it. We have 15 seconds left in this opening quarter. In a game that started off like wildfire. The first 2 minutes and 4 seconds, we had two touchdowns scored. Goodson comes out of the ball game, and he was nursing a hand he was going to get treatment on yesterday, and he is holding something on that same arm. We'll check and see. 14-10, Miami leads it. This presentation of college football presented by Best Buy will continue after this message and a word from our ABC stations. Well, we are back, College Station, Texas, and that always famous home of the 12th man. Our score 14-10 as we open the second period of play. Aggies scored first on their first play after a penalty, and then Miami came right back with a 19-yard touchdown of their own. Johnson, pressure, and is going to be sacked way back at the 48-yard line. Ojomo is the man who came through.
And Bill Young, it was interesting talking to Bill Young, the first-year defensive coordinator for Miami. Came down from Kansas, so he knows Texas A&M's personnel very well. But he said that this defensive line and linebacker crew has picked up the defense so much faster than he thought that he's been able to put in a lot more calls. And you're seeing the diversity of blitzes that Miami can run, and A&M's offense having a hard time with an inexperienced offensive line picking it up.
Mike Goodson is the lone setback this time. Dumps it over the middle. A lot of running room. 45-40. And then Goodson is smacked down by number 31, Sean Spence, the freshman out of Northwestern High School in Miami. Now the X Factor, presented by City.
Well, we'll go with Brantley, and he's trotting out to the field. You talked about how good he was on his first punt. Now, let's see him do the pooch punt, where he's going to have to try to drop it down inside the 10-yard line, something he's worked on a lot.
I talked about his high school, Sealy High School, right down on the interstate, headed into Houston. It's where Eric Dickerson played. You remember Dickerson and James, own Craig James, who went to the Pony Express? Well, they were college teammates, but Eric is from Sealy as well.
That's
boy,
a nice kick.
This is a nice job on the pooch. I mean, it goes dead inside the 10. It is obvious. This kid can not only kick them far, he is a student of the kicking game. We'll take a timeout. Miami with their worst field position.
watching ESPN College Football on ABC, presented by Best Buy.
The Buick Pontiac and GMC employee discount on every 2008. And now, many 2009s. You pay what we pay, but only until September 30th.
Now get a Pontiac G6 with better combined fuel efficiency than Honda Accord, starting at just $16,720. Hurry, these are the final days of the GM employee discount for everyone event. See your dealer by September 30th.
Sometimes just getting to retirement seems impossible. That's where we come in. As one of the nation's 401k leaders, the Principal offers many simple ways to plan for retirement, making it easier for you to get where you're going. Woo-hoo! The Principal Financial Group will give you an edge.
We got it!
Got what?
The Grail.
50 million credit cards, IDs, account numbers, everything.
The Grail.
You said we couldn't hack the network?
So we took it, all of it.
Guys, that's an IBM server. It's got cryptographic coprocessors, RACF, Mondo encryption. I can't break that.
Guess we'll have to take it back then.
From the network that changes lives on Extreme Makeover Home Edition comes a brand new series that celebrates the families who stay together and play together.
The game is on!
Starting Tuesday, ABC will crisscross the country to bring the season's biggest new show right to your door. All you need to know is everything about your family.
What is the name of the girl your brother has a secret crush on?
Each week, a new house, a new family, and a new opportunity to make dreams come true. Will you be ready?
That's what I'm talking about!
When opportunity knocks, premieres Tuesday, 8, 7 Central, part of National Stay-at-Home Week on ABC.
Last week, Hurricane Ike hammered Houston and tore up Galveston just a couple of hours, about 90 miles or so down the road. Carla was a devastating hurricane back in the 60s, but this one, according to many, because of the location it hit, it came through Galveston and then went right up the ship channel at Houston. And you have to say kudos to the harbor authority down there because that port is back open again. We would like to say a reminder, log on to www.redcross.org for more information on this hurricane and how you can get involved and help with your dollars. Running play broken, big opening, and one man to beat. This is Thomas. Deron Thomas, a third running back we have not seen in the ball game. They have a stable over there.
And the problem right now for Texas A&M is whoever Miami is giving the ball to is finding a ton of running room. Great block by Patrick Hill, the fullback. Brought him in from El Camino Community College out in California. He opens that hole, and both Thomas and Cooper haven't had to make a move. They've been able to run right at the line of scrimmage and just accelerate.
As they say, the shortest line. Straight line between 2 points. And that's what they're doing. From the 43-yard line after bad field position, Marr, great move to get away from the defender, now runs back into harm's way and dumps it off complete. And this is Thomas who will take it out to around the 49-yard line. Jack Arute, let's check in with you.
Yeah, Ron, thank you. We have Texas A&M's first female and Hispanic president, Dr. Elsa Morano, from Miami, by the way. We were just talking about the effects, the after effects of Hurricane Ike, and it affected the Texas A&M family, specific the Galveston campus. Tell me what happened there.
Yes, we have a campus in Galveston, Texas, and even though the buildings weren't really damaged that much, there's no water or electricity, so we had to get as many of our faculty and students back here, 1,300 of them, starting classes next week.
All right, we want to ask you one more question, but Ron, let's get this play first.
Okay, we've got a second down. Miami throws the pass complete for what appears to be a first down to Epps. Back to you, Jack.
I got to tell you, watching here with Dr. Morano, and she's more excited than Joe Kimes, the defensive coordinator. I understand when you first came here, you told the head coach of Texas A&M what?
I said, if you win no other game, you've got to win the Miami game. You got to beat those Hurricanes. I went to school at Florida International University, and we are big rivals of UM. We got to beat them. We're going to win this game.
Guys, I'm not kidding. She is all excited, and you know what the coach told her. He said, get in line. We got Texas, Texas A&M, Texas Tech. Miami's on the list now.
Yeah. Hey, thanks, Jack. We appreciate the new president coming on with us. Deep pass. And it is tipped and almost caught on the rebound by another Miami player 5 yards deep in the end zone, Devon Johnson. Arkeith Brown got a tip off.
Nice job by Arkeith Brown. This ball was thrown late and underthrown. Young receiver needs to learn to maybe stop. That's Travis Benjamin, who's the fastest player on Miami. And, of course,
look at the president's
very
reaction.
Happy that that was not a touchdown for Miami. We just found out how much she dislikes Miami.
Elsa Morano, the first female and Hispanic president of Texas A&M University here in College Station. It'll be second down and 10 from the 45. Aggie show blitz. They come up the wide side of the field, but Marv showing great mobility. 45 and very wisely goes down. It's only a gain of 3, but they had him dead to rights 10 yards behind the line.
Well, if there's one guy who knows how tough and athletic Robert Marv is, it's Joe Kimes, the new defensive coordinator at A&M, one of the coaches who spent time in the NFL. Joe Kimes coached linebackers at Tampa Bay and actually coached Robert Marv's father, Eugene, and recruited him to Alabama. Younger Marv was going to go to Alabama until there was a coaching change, ended up in Miami. So Joe Kimes understands how tough this young man is as an athlete.
Jerron Thomas in the ballgame at tailback. They fake it to him. Marv throws it complete, and I mean on a rope. Tackle is broken inside the 25, and he's down to the 23, and Marv is still down. He took quite a lick. Farquharson is on the man on the receiving end, but it was Von Miller who hit the quarterback, and he is still down on a knee.
And now an Aggie also down on about the 22-yard line. So we'll get our first chance to see Ja'Cory Harris, the heralded true freshman. Marv did everything he could to hang in the pocket. Took one right in the ribs.
Well, when you have just delivered the ball like that, you are so vulnerable as far as the ribcage.
And it's something quarterbacks either have or they don't. Able to stand in there, step into the ball. You see that so much with quarterbacks wanting to fall away from that.
You can see the patch that they wear for the ribs. But the trainer also put his hand up a little bit higher, like in the sternum area. And very legal hit. No head down or anything like that. But it's just you're wide open and vulnerable to the hit. And a good round of applause from this very football savvy community here at College Station. Marv, 8 of 10, 87 yards, no touchdowns.
And that was Danny Gore, senior quarterback, who was down for A&M. He also up on his own power and over on the sidelines.
So the situation, first and 10 Miami. They have it at the 22. And Ja'Cory Harris, also a freshman, and he's out of Northwestern High School of Miami, as several of his teammates are. First play for him, 6'4", 185, and a freshman. Here comes a blitz. Delivers his pass and threw it behind a wide-open wide receiver, Richard Gordon. Let's check in with Jackaroo. Jack?
Well, guys, remember, this is not Ja'Cory Harris's first trip to Texas. He brought his Northwestern school to play here in a high school championship game against, in Dallas, the South Lake Carroll Dragons, who were previously undefeated. Guess what? Ja'Cory Harris, he went 21-28, 280 yards, 4 TDs, and they went back to Miami with the victory. Harris is unflappable. He kind of likes Texas.
I think you're right. Eighth play of the drive. It started back at the 9-yard line. Running play. Nice job by the defense of Texas A&M as he's forced out of bounds at the 20. It'll be third down and 8. Thomas tackled by Alton Dixon.
Well, you were talking about Northwestern High School. It looks to me like Marv is going to be okay, probably just has to catch his breath. But it's amazing the recruiting that's going on here at Miami. Tim Tebow was Mr. Football in the state of Florida. Things have worked out just okay.
He's from Nice.
Yeah,
playing high school, Marv.
And the next two guys Miami has gotten, and that's what we're seeing now. This reminds me a lot of what Butch Davis did in that 97-98 time frame.
From the shotgun, middle screen, Benjamin, Travis Benjamin, breaks off a tackle, takes it inside the 10. It'll be first and goal to Hurricanes at the 9:51 mark until halftime.
It's been a while since Miami has had a smallish receiver who can do this in space, and a lot of people around the program are mentioning the name Devin Hester when they talk about Travis Benjamin. Many of his defensive teammates during camp, his true freshmen came in, they said this man is simply uncatchable in the open field.
First and goal for the Hurricanes. They lead it 14-10. Harris, straight handoff up the middle. Defense is there. It's going to be written down for a loss. Von Miller tackles Deron Thomas, and it will be a second down and goal, and the new line of scrimmage is going to be back at the 12.
5 yards. Sometimes you just got to take what you get, and Thomas, who is a senior, tries to bounce that outside and goes backwards. Now, even though there is not the opportunity for a first down and second and goal unless there's a penalty, now you're really behind the sticks, as the saying goes.
We haven't seen Cooper in a while. And a timeout is going to be called by Miami. So let's take a timeout. 8:53 left until halftime. It's Miami 14-10, and they're threatening.
Our neighbors, they come for a really good time, a really good meal, and a really good deal. Like Applebee's all-you-can-eat feast, starting at just $9.99. Choose from all-you-can-eat riblets, all-you-can-eat shrimp, or all-you-can-eat chicken fingers. Hey, is that all-you-can-eat? All-you-can-eat riblets, shrimp, or chicken fingers, starting at just $9.99 for a limited time only and only at Applebee's. It's a whole new neighborhood.
Everything okay, Carl?
I'm winning, right?
Yeah, but the other drivers think Aflac sponsorship's giving you an advantage.
Sick and you can't work, Aflac pays cash fast to help keep you in the race.
I know, but they see it a little differently. I taught him that.
Aflac. Ask about it at work.
The Buick Pontiac and GMC employee discount on every 2008. And now, many 2009s. You pay what we pay, but only until September 30th.
Now get a Pontiac G6 with better combined fuel efficiency than Honda Accord. Starting at just $16,720. Hurry, these are the final days of the GM Employee Discount for Everyone event. See your dealer by September 30th.
Tomorrow is the greatest night for seeing stars. At 7, 6 Central, a Jimmy special like you've never seen before. With Selma Hayek, Ryan Seacrest, Barbara Walters, and Michael Phelps.
You pee in the pool, true?
Everybody does.
Jimmy Kimmel's Big Night of Stars. And at 8, 7 Central, just when you thought the list of stars couldn't get any bigger, it just did. Oprah Winfrey makes a special guest appearance at the Primetime Emmys. It all starts tomorrow at 7, 6 Central on ABC.
ESPN College Football on ABC, brought to you by the G6 from Pontiac, official performance machines of the NCAA. The Principal Financial Group, we'll give you an edge. And Verizon Wireless.
Well, the 12th man just outside of Kyle Field. The Miami Hurricanes, very, very nice balance today. Rushing yardage, 106. Passing yardage, 100. For the 206. Not only nice balance, but that is a very high total. We still have almost 9 minutes left to play.
And with a young quarterback, Ja'Cory Harris, I wouldn't be surprised with a roll right, a run-pass option, because this is a very athletic young quarterback.
Here comes the blitz from the wide side of the field. They dump it out in the flat, and that's Thomas. Thomas will take it inside the five, and he's down to the three. It'll be third down and goal, Miami.
One of the things that Patrick Nix, the offensive coordinator from Miami, told us, that both of his young quarterbacks made strides this week during the bye week, getting ready in recognition, understanding what the defense is trying to do. That time pressure came from Harris's right. He very quickly went to his check down, and a nice gain. Now you're at a more manageable position in third and goal.
And this is the 12th play of the drive. It all started back at the 9-yard line. Third down and goal. Aggies creeping up, and they come with a blitz. Pass over the middle. It is knocked down. Incomplete. Arkeith Brown got a hand on it. Khalil Jones was the man that they wanted for the reception, but he was covered.
Second nice play by Arkeith Brown. He was the one who broke up that long pass earlier to Benjamin. That time, an excellent job. Did not drape the right arm on the receiver. Reached around with his left hand, so no pass interference.
So there's going to be Bosher to attempt a field goal. I would assume it would be officially 21 yards. It's just beyond the 10. Good pass, and the kick is right down the middle. So they'll say officially 20 yards on the field goal, and it's good. And our new score, Miami 17, Texas A&M 10. We'll be right back.
The Buick Pontiac and GMC employee discount on every 2008. And now, many 2009s. You pay what we pay. But only until September 30th.
Now get a Pontiac G6 with better combined fuel efficiency than Honda Accord. Starting at just $16,720. Hurry, these are the final days of the GM Employee Discount for Everyone event. See your dealer by September 30th.
Pacific Life has been the power behind successful individuals for more than 140 years. Pacific Life's strength includes assets exceeding $100 billion. Ask your financial professional about how Pacific Life can help you reach your retirement goals. Pacific Life, the power to help you succeed.
Would you like to put a stop to your partner snoring so you could go to sleep and stay asleep every night? Introducing Pure Sleep, the stop snoring solution. Common snoring is caused when the airway is constricted, causing the soft palate to vibrate. Pure Sleep is a patented self-molded mouthpiece cleared by the FDA, which holds the jaw slightly forward, opening the airway so that the snoring stops. Look at the difference in these before and after images.
That is just the astounding thing. I have not snored. And so this thing works. It's easy to use, easy to mold, works like a charm.
I'm sleeping through the night, and so is he, and we're waking up with more energy and not waking up in the middle of the night to say shh.
If it doesn't work, we'll refund the purchase price, refund the original shipping charge, and even pay to ship it back. Try Pure Sleep risk-free.
Visit us at puresleep.com.
Dancing with the Stars, live three-night premiere, Monday on ABC.
And it's time now to take a look at our Aflac trivia question. Okay.
Have to have the duck.
As Kansas quarterback Nona Cromwell once ran for 294 yards in a single game, who holds the FBS 1A record for quarterback rushing in a career?
I didn't bring my laptop. And Nolan Cromwell is up there somewhere, the offensive coordinator for Texas A&M.
Circle exactly where? I want to believe you now.
He's right there.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
Yeah. Right. They have those windows with the sunshades on them, so we can't get a good shot of Mr. Cromwell.
Here comes the kickoff. Miami on top by a touchdown. This is very short from the 12-yard line. Is Gray. Gray almost runs into his own man, and he'll take it back out to the 30. Matt Weiner, let's check in with you in New York.
All right, Ron, here's our nominee for the Pontiac game-changing performance.
unbeaten East Carolina in overtime with NC State. Patrick Pinckney has it knocked loose by Shea McKean, and the Wolfpack will take advantage. Forget messing around with the field goal. Andre Brown takes care of it with a 10-yard touchdown, and the Wolfpack win. Vote for this week's Pontiac game-changing performance starting tomorrow morning at 9 on ESPN.com.
So our congratulations to the Wolfpack. Winning a big one there. East Carolina's been run shot over everybody. Blitz is on. Johnson got by him. He throws complete to Jeff Fuller. Big strike right there, because I'm telling you, Johnson was dead in the water. Instead of a minus 7, it's going to be a plus 17. Glenn Cook is the man who missed it.
Johnson did a nice job that time of stepping up into the pocket after he eludes the rush. Steps right up into his throw and delivers a strike. We've seen him a couple of times fall back away from the pressure, and doesn't quite have the arm strength of Stephen McGee, so a much better job adjusting his feet and stepping into the throw.
Pitch back goes to Gray. Nothing to the open side of the field. He'll run it back into the boundary and will be shoved out of bounds at around the 50-yard line. One of the things that is not high percentage, and that is to when you have to reverse your field, that a defense as quick as Miami, they will run you down from behind more times than not. And we have a Miami player down, shaken up.
Looks like Marcus Forston, another freshman out of Northwestern High School in Miami.
Coaches really think he is going to be not a good, but a great player. Mammoth young fella, 6'2", 308.
We were talking about Northwestern High School. They were last year's consensus national champions. At the high school level, 8 players from that team signed with the Miami Hurricanes.
So, from what I'm being told in the truck, you can see the injury coming up right here.
There he is, right there. We have our telestrator back, so we're able to circle again.
Stepped on someone's foot. That's the kind of injury that's far more akin to happening in basketball when you come down on a rebound and step on someone.
Well, they're working on that left shoulder. I wonder if he also landed not only maybe the ankle, but that's a big guy to help up. But I wonder if he landed on that left elbow and it jammed his shoulder.
I don't know, but that young lady, when she goes to the sideline, may say, if we have any more defensive linemen go down, we need a third person on the field.
At least a third.
Yes.
It was interesting talking to Randy Shannon when he was going through the players, the young players he liked. Marcus Forston didn't even call him. Everybody calls him Boone.
That's right.
Not quite sure, but it seems to be fitting.
So we got 3 running backs in the ball game again, as the direct snap is going to go for very short yardage. And you have to say one thing when you talk about Randy Shannon, and you look at that Miami bench, there is a situation where you see all these kids from Northwestern High School coming to Miami, and 2 back-to-back State of Florida Mr. Footballs. I don't think there's any question that this gentleman can recruit and recruit very well.
It was interesting bringing in Bill Young, the defensive coordinator, so he could stop thinking about defense completely. It's all about recruiting and special teams. And 2 years in a row, if not the top rated recruiting class, very near the top in every service. So things going pretty well on the recruiting trail for Shannon.
Pressure from the backside. Johnson again gets away. Across the body. Throws complete, and that is Fuller, and he'll have the first down. Twice now, because of his size and elusiveness, Johnson should have been tackled for a loss, and he breaks by the defender.
They have had to make some adjustments with Johnson to step up into the pocket. I promise you that Tom Rossley, the quarterback coach, who's been around this game forever, at the highest level as a head coach at SMU, worked with Johnson and said, stop bailing from the pressure, get up into it. And that time finds one of the talented true freshmen for A&M in Jeff Fuller.
He is out of McKinney, Texas, played at Boyd High School. First down from the 24. Fake the punt. Flag comes down. It's going to be holding. Now throws it and has it complete. That's Fuller again. That combination may become famous.
Fuller took a shot. had to reach up for that ball, and I think similar to what happened to Robert Marv, we got the wind knocked out of him.
Got rolled up on that football. You're right.
Fuller, of course, he's
holding. Offense, number 12. 10 yards from the previous spot. Remains first down.
LaMontilla, the reserve fullback. Well, here's a reminder. Tonight on ABC, and you'll not be watching this one unless we're not done traveling. Number 3, Georgia, takes on Arizona State. This one out in Tempe. Saturday Night Football presented by Southwest Airlines at ABC tonight, 8 o'clock Eastern Time.
Now that game, I think, comes all down to Arizona State's offensive line. If they can't protect Rudy Carpenter, I think it's going to be a long night if they can. Carpenter's good enough, I think, to keep them in that ball game at home.
Fumbled snap from center. Johnson did the very wise thing and fell forward and made the recovery. My first thought, and you and I talked about it yesterday, but Arizona State played Texas last year in the Holiday Bowl. Quickness was the difference in the ball game. Georgia may be they may be quicker than Texas is, so Arizona State better be ready for another dose of the same.
Yeah, I watched a lot of that Georgia-South Carolina game. And it just doesn't quite look like Georgia has it all going. Granted, they have so many guys hurt on the offensive line. But if they're not going full speed and Carpenter get protection, I think it'd be competitive. If not, I agree with you. I think it could get out of hand.
Here's Goodson. Nothing to the right. Breaks it out. Has 5, has 10. Counted off at about 15 yards. And Mike Goodson right there. Going back to what Ed talked about earlier, because he runs so smoothly, he may not look like he's moving that fast, but I'm telling you, he is as good as any running back in the Big 12 Conference. I don't think there's any question about that.
And now, if you're Jim Young, you've got to think, as Goodson comes off, they haven't thrown it downfield too much in this situation. They've done some quarterback runs. I would be thinking some type of wide receiver screen. So Bill Young likes to bring pressure. Maybe you go with a little zone, expecting some type of wide receiver screen for A&M.
Keandre Smith comes back into the ball game. And in case you joined us late, he did not play the first two ball games. He has been injured. This is his first game to play this afternoon. Had a foot injury. Johnson trying to run, looks for help, and he dropped the football. And as they scramble, the Aggies have recovered at the 32. And he's a freshman, but again, they got a whisper in his ear. This is Miami. They can run, son.
Yeah.
They can run. And it probably took him out of field goal range, which is freshman error.
Yeah. You've got to tuck it away. There's too much speed. And then the lost yardage. And Bean is out there, but this is right on the edge of his range. This would be a career long by a lot.
This is going to be 48 yards from the near hash mark. Trying to make it a 17-13 ball game. Gets a good pass, plenty of distance on this one, but he's going to be wide left. He yanked it, trying to hit it a little too hard, and will take a timeout. Miami maintains 7-point lead, 3:22 left until halftime. And right now, let's take a look at the Pacific Life game summary. We're going to do it right after this play. 17-10. That's a promise. First down at the 31-yard line. Again, Aggie show blitz. Quick out pass, and what a defensive stop at the 25-yard line by Texas A&M. It's Peterson. Jordan Peterson, who had an interception 2 weeks ago in that game against New Mexico.
And Peterson, a young man. They wish he was a little taller. They wish he was a little faster, and it looks like that is number 76, Chris Rutledge, the right guard, who is down. But Peterson does an excellent job of seeing that thing the whole way. The one thing Joe Kine said that he does perfectly, he has great vision. He sees things happening and reacts very quickly. Of course, the touchdown against New Mexico on an INT return is proof of that.
Well, as we mentioned to you, it is Rutledge who is down, the starting right guard, a senior out of Miami. And he is getting up right now. And back into the lineup is Greg, don't call me Craig, Cooper.
Yeah,
he's got 3 carries for 77 yards and 2 touchdowns.
Yeah, I think you'd want to get him some playing time.
Here's the Pacific Life game summary.
Well, it was the first official play from scrimmage. There was a penalty before it on a screen. Goodson takes it 62. And here's what we're talking about. 3 rushes, 77 yards, a 19-yard touchdown, and a 51-yard touchdown. Good to see him back in the game if you're a Miami fan.
Well, they faked it to him, and they throw that middle screen. And this is Collier. Collier is going to take it out to the 36-yard line. And if someone has not screamed to the defense, including Joe Kynes, they need to scream. Cooper's back on the field. Make sure you know where number two is.
Ja'Cory Harris still in at quarterback. Robert Marv, of course, had the wind, looked like the wind knocked out of him, but we knew he was going to play. So doubt that this is because of the injury. They wanted to, they're going to keep rotating these young freshmen.
Khalil Jones comes in motion. Pass near sideline, overthrown as the receiver slipped. And that was Collier. He tried to regain his footing, and it is a hold defensively. Fourth down coming up for the Aggies, and they're on their feet.
And this is part of the plan for Miami to rotate these guys. And
Joe,
well, he was retired a year ago. He doesn't look so retired today, does it?
Well, he said he was going to retire, and then he told his very best friends that. And then Mike Sherman called up, and he said, hey, I'm in a bind. I need the help. He said, I can't ever let a friend down. This punt of the run by Bosher, 24-yard line. This is Pugh, and he'll be stopped at the 30. So let's answer the Aflac trivia question, which was involving offense coordinator Nolan Cromwell here at Texas A&M. As a Kansas quarterback, Nolan once ran for 294 yards in a single game. Who holds the FBS record for quarterback rushing in a career?
You know, I thinking about this, it's got to be
Vince Young.
No, I think it's D. Dallas from Air Force.
Okay, yeah.
Because of the option. But, you know, Vince. Ooh.
Brad Smith of Missouri, 42-89.
Because Chase Daniels had such a good career up to this point, I think a lot of people forget how good Brad Smith was when he was at Missouri.
Running play straight ahead. Whoa. Mike Goodson just gets covered up with Miami defenders. We're about to go under 2 minutes. In fact, we have left in this first half. Now, in timeouts, what do we got? Miami still has two left. And on this play right here, they stopped the Aggies for no gain or for loss. I think you could look for them to use one of those two.
A&M hustling up to the line. They want to save theirs as much as they can.
Pressure up the middle. Goodson, flag is down. Whoa, what a hit. Glenn Cook will get credit for the tackle now. We got illegal downfield or what? He caught that beyond the line of scrimmage, didn't he?
Now, Texas A&M now getting an illegal shift. We've seen Miami have some trouble when they were on offense earlier.
Legal motion.
Excuse
offense.
Me.
Tight end was not set at the snap. 5 yards from the previous block. Remains second down.
Well, coming up on the Cooper Tires halftime report, it'll be John, Craig, that's the man from Otter Creek, you know, and Doug, and they'll have highlights and scores right here on this network. 17-10, Miami.
On A&M, because an offensive penalty, the clock started. They're going awfully slow here. Miami, two timeouts. Wouldn't be surprised to see a timeout after this.
Johnson going to run it out of bounds. It's a 25-yard line. And it was Antonio Dixon who was in pursuit of him. Now we have 70 seconds left until halftime.
And this is where you start to see Stephen McGee not being in there. This does not look like Gerard Johnson is comfortable running the hurry-up offense. It's hard to tell right now what A&M wants to do. Do they want to milk it and try to get into halftime, or do they want to try to make something happen? And Johnson, who was a wide receiver the first couple of weeks of the season, I'm not quite sure what A&M is trying to do here, but now with third and long goes out of bounds, Miami's going to have a timeout if they don't pick up the first down. And
pretty close game, 220 yards each.
Yeah, this is just looking bad for A&M.
Prior to the snap, timeout. Texas A&M, their first charge timeout of the half.
And let's check in back in New York with Matt Weiner. Matt.
Thank you, Ron. The Sports Center right now is powered by Vizio. And a good moment. The final weekend for the home team at Yankee Stadium. Robinson Cano's walk-off single gave the Yanks a 1-0 win over Baltimore. which means the Tampa Bay Rays still haven't clinched their first ever playoff appearance. The Rays lead the Twins 2-0 in the third inning in Tampa.
So welcome back to College Station. Ron Franklin along with Ed Cunningham and Jack Arute down on the sideline. We had a game that started off at a furious pace, and we had barely played 2 minutes and 4 seconds, and we already had two touchdowns. A&M scored on a 62-yard pass play to Goodson from Johnson, and then Miami came right back with Cooper with a 19-yard run. He duplicated with an even longer jaunt of 51 yards. A couple of field goals to throw in there, and that's how we stand at 17-10. Miami on top. Third down, line to make, the 41. Johnson throws it behind his intended receiver, McCoy.
Now, Miami could end up, Brantley's a great punter, so he's going to have to lay out. But with all of the speed and Randy Shannon now working so hard on special teams, I bet he's got something up his sleeve, bringing some pressure, try to get a block. But either way, they could end up with pretty good field position and two timeouts.
And if you don't know what we're talking about, Randy has always been, since he's been in Miami, not always, but been the defensive coordinator. But he has given that over to Bill Young. This is a booming kick, and he is charged with the head man of special teams. This is Benjamin, far sideline, and he can fly. Benjamin still on his feet and all the way down to the 40-yard line, and an A&M player really got whacked, and I mean whacked down hard at the 35. Slow to get up, and in fact one of the Miami trainers has come out to try to assist him.
Benjamin did an excellent job waiting and getting over to the block of Colin McCarthy.
It's Kenny Brown.
Yeah.
Got taken out. 60 yards on the kick, but he had 44 on the return.
But Benjamin went to his right to set up. Nice, make the first man miss and then get to the block. And watch the block coming to your right. McCarthy just lays out Kenny Brown, who usually plays wide receiver, and Miami in great position now with their timeouts.
I'd turn and hand the ball to Cooper. I wouldn't throw it. Pass thrown complete, but that's Epps. As back in the ball game is Robert Marv to run the 2 minute offense.
Oh, wow, that took too long. They should have gotten this timeout. I think he was down with about 39 seconds left, and Marv wasn't quite sure what to do. He should have known he had to take the timeout.
So we'll take a timeout. We'll be right back.
Oh, hey, ref, come on. You couldn't make a call in a phone booth. Come on.
Nothing.
It's not as fun when it happens to you. Be a good sport.
Hey, Dorothy, Oz called. They want the bricks back.
So we're back. 32 seconds left until halftime. Jack Arute, what do you got for us?
Well, you were talking about why they didn't get that timeout faster. Well, Randy Shannon was trying to get the timeout. He went to Jim Caporra and said, I need the timeout. Jim's the side judge. Jim went to blow the whistle. It fell out. So Randy was lobbying to have 3 seconds put back on the clock.
Is that how long it takes a whistle to fall out and hit the ground?
Hey, you got to try something. Nice try.
Second down from the 35-yard line of Texas A&M. Near sideline, got it complete, and he steps out of bounds immediately at the 26. And that's Johnson, Aldarius Johnson, a freshman from guess where? Northwestern High School in Miami.
Shocker. And that was a wonderful throw by Marv. Knew he had to work the sideline. They got the timeout, went over to Patrick Nix, and that's one of the big reasons Nix is down on the field with these young players. Calm him down, say, it's okay. We lost a few seconds. Get one to the sideline, and he did.
You could see the concerned look on Joe Kine's face, because as nice a job as Ja'Cory Harris did, Robert Marv seems to be more in control of the situation, particularly on that pass. Steps up, throws far side, wide open on a blown coverage. It'll be touchdown, Miami Hurricane. Collier, 26 yards, and he looked like the first guy out to practice.
Oh.
Collier ran what's called a wheel route, and the defensive back passed him off, thinking there was a safety behind him, and there wasn't. What a great job by Marv to recognize the blown coverage on that side and not panic. And that's a hard catch to make.
Basha with the extra point attempt. Yeah, when you're that all alone and also looking into a high sky, Marv looks at him and says, good heavens, is it December the 25th? It is certainly Christmas. Free touchdown.
Do you wonder? Do you challenge? Do you compete? Do you win? Do you lead? Do you follow? Do you honor? Do you wonder? Well, then, welcome to Aggieland. Enjoy your stay.
So stay tuned for the Cooper Tires halftime report. That's coming up here shortly.
Collier doing a nice job. He ran what's called the wheel route, which means it looks like you're running to the flat, and then you turn and go up the field. And there was only two defensive backs on that side. The inside nickelback passed him off when he went to run that flat route, assuming that he was going to the flat. He had a corner to the outside. Collier went right by him, and he probably should have waved his arm in the end zone for a fair catch. That ball was looked like it hung up there forever before it dropped into his lap.
So Basher will kick it off, and our new score, 24-10, Miami. And a pooch kick. Fair catch is signal for Jaworski. Lane calls for the fair catch very wisely and makes it at the 33. Well, ABC's Emmy-nominated Dancing with the Stars returns on Monday with a three-night live premiere event. Now, here are some of the athletes this year. Warren Sapp, Misty May Traynor, the wonderful volleyball player, won a gold at the past Olympics. Maurice Green. And 13 new stars competing to be the biggest and most demanding season yet.
Mike Sherman, of course, almost did some dancing with Warren Sapp. He and Warren got into a war of words after Warren had a legal yet questionable block against one of his offensive linemen that really hurt the young man. And Mike Sherman and Warren went at it for a few weeks back and forth.
That's verbally.
Yes.
Good point. Spinning around after a gain of about 5 yards. And that's going to be the final play. 3 seconds, 2 seconds, down to one. That will be the end of the first half here at Kyle Field. And that blown coverage with the Aggie defense, if they had really played a nice first half. Let's go down to Jackaroo.
All right, with Randy Shannon. Randy, tell me if there's one thing that stood out in that first half that you liked, what was it?
Well, the way the offense came out and got explosives, we're throwing the ball pretty good right now, and the guys are also taking advantage of it. They're doing a great job on the pass protection. The quarterbacks are doing a nice job. The thing that's disappointing, we got to do a better job at tackling. We're doing a very bad job at tackling the football on defense. So halftime adjustments got to play a major part of what we're doing on defense.
What sort of adjustments will you make at halftime?
Well, we got to emphasize. I think guys are going for kill shots, trying to, you know, make the crowd feel happy, but we just got to get the guys on the ground and not go for kill shots.
Thanks, Coach.
Thank you.
Okay, Jack. Thanks, Coach. We appreciate the time. Stay tuned for the Cooper Tires halftime report. Miami leads this one by 14. It's right after these messages. So it's Miami as we open the third quarter with a 14-point lead over the home-standing Texas Aggies. Welcome back to college football presented by Best Buy. And, Ed, I'm not alone in asking this question because I have a feeling that a lot of people would like to know the same answer, and that is, how in the world did that Miami receiver get so wide open? I said at the time he looked like the first guy out to practice, and he did. He was all alone.
Almost looked like they should have given a fair catch. But let's take a look at the Best Buy playbook, and we'll draw it up for you. Of course, Collier's the inside receiver, but look at Arkeith Brown on the outside. As Collier goes to run up the field, Brown thinks this is man-to-man coverage. He points like my guy is going inside. Jordan Pugh, who's on the inside, releases the deep route, which was his man if they were in man. The question is, was it zone or man? It doesn't matter. Total blown coverage now for Joe Kines, the defensive coordinator for Texas A&M. Those adjustments have to be made, but I think the biggest adjustment, I think he's got to start moving his defensive linemen around, because when they're standing in there, the holes have been huge. I think he's got to slant and stunt those guys some.
So that's how we stand, 24-10, as we open the third quarter of play. Miami won the toss to begin the ball game, and they waited until the second half, and now they get the kickoff. So leading by 14, and they got the ball again. And this one is not going to be returned. It's 5 yards deep. Right now, let's take a look at the Pacific Life game summary.
Well, we'll look at the statistics. And for Miami, it has been extremely impressive offensively, almost 10 yards per play. Craig Cooper has rushed for 77 yards on 3 carries. And for A&M, it has not been that bad offensively. It's just those little mistakes, the fumble that backed them out of field goal range. Of course, they tried and missed. You've got a quarterback making his first start, and that's what you're seeing with A&M offensively, is little mistakes hurting themselves.
Yeah, particularly that play when the freshman went back and got caught and then fumbled the ball, and it caused that field goal attempt to be, well, he tried a little harder than he would have had he had it 10 yards further up the field. Jack Arute, let's check in with you.
Well, fellas, I know all of us wanted to know why Patrick Nix may have elected to take Greg Cooper out of the game as early as he did in that start of that second quarter. I caught up with him and I asked him. He said, Jack, just look around. See how hot it is? The fact that we don't have baby J, Javaris James. He said, I told Coop we were going to leave him out. He said, but I'll tell you one thing. You're going to see a lot of him in the third and the fourth quarter.
Okay. Well, pretty soon here, he's going to be able to run in the shade as the shadows are beginning to take over, about 15% of the field on the sideline. On second down, this pass just a little too far in front at the 28-yard line. Khalil Jones is the man that he wanted, and you can see Robert Maher pointing to himself, my bad.
Yeah, and that's one thing these coaches talk about, these young quarterbacks. They're not afraid of taking blame. And Patrick Nix has been taking a lot of heat down in Miami for quote-unquote conservative play calling. But with young quarterbacks, young receivers, you start to see now with an extra week, he's able to take the wraps off a little bit. He could not hurt the psyche of these young players. Lay off the Knicks. This guy's a good young play caller.
Well, you've got to put him in a position to succeed. You don't want to throw him to the Wolves right off the top. Middle screen and close to the first down, but not enough. And it'll be punting time for Miami. Farquharson is the man on the receiving end and tackled immediately by Featherston. Third time that Miami will have to punt. And we'll see if that halftime pep talk got this offense going again. Bosher awaits the snap at the 13. Good coverage kick. Not going to turn over. But a fair catch is called for at the 24 by Jordan Pugh. And let's check in again with Jack Arute following that 48-yard punt. Jack?
Yeah, I was talking to a lot of coaches at halftime. I caught up with Mike Sherman, and he did something that I was a little bit surprised early in a season the way he did. He got his troops around. He talked about the lack of execution, some sloppy play, and then he challenged his entire team, guys. He said, the best 30 minutes of your entire season had darn well better be played right now. Interesting.
Yep. He knows, though, the same thing that Randy Shannon knows, and that is what we're talking about with Coach Nix and what he's trying to do with that offense. You got to put him into a position to succeed, as that reverse goes absolutely nowhere with Gray at a loss of about 5. You got to put them where they can succeed, and then they grow from that.
And let's be honest about what we're dealing with A&M. New offense, totally different system than what Dennis Franchione and his staff ran.
Offensive line virtually.
Had to replace 4 guys, had to replace 3 tight ends, lost their 2 top receivers, have a quarterback starting for the first time, and I know people want it to happen overnight. Just not going to. These teams have a long way to go with a lot of young talent.
This is Goodson. Has 5, has 10, counted off at about 13 yards on the play, almost a first down. We're going to see officially a 14-yard gain, and it's JoJo Nicholas on the stop for Miami.
When Goodson gets going and accelerating, you mentioned earlier, maybe best in the conference. I think you start looking around the country at speedbacks, and now he's added the power with 20 pounds. And that was the knock on the previous staff, was they didn't figure out how to use this man's talent. Well, I promise you, Mike Sherman and his staff are going to keep figuring it out.
Aggies on third down conversions are 4 of 9. You need about a half yard here, and I'll tell you, they're not going to get it. Boy, that defense stepped up and just slammed the door. It's a loss of a yard in the play. Glenn Cook from his middle linebacking spot against with Mark Cure.
And watch inside and watch the pressure coming. This is Bill Young is doing everything to get his young people to move, and that was an excellent job. Moncur comes underneath the tackle, who doesn't read it fast enough. They're using their athleticism.
And they told me before the game Moncur was not going to be able to play.
He looked okay there.
He looked okay there. Sure did.
Great call by Bill Young too.
So it's fourth down and a punting situation for Texas A&M. Lazy spiral. Going to hit, and boy, it takes a huge A&M bounce and is going to go out of bounds at the 14-yard line. When we come back, we will be with an old friend and a very special guest following that 52-yard punt.
Hey, Vincent!
Go State!
Hey, Ham. Why did that guy call you Vincent?
Because that's my real name, Bergwood.
It is? How do you know that?
He's my Allstate agent.
Oh, he insures your car.
And my boat.
You got a boat?
Ugh, my wife is a big-time skier.
You're married?
Allstate agents know who you really are and what you really need. Call one today for a free Good Hands coverage checkup. Are you in good hands?
Where'd you meet your wife?
Pilates.
She's European.
There are those who dedicate themselves to a sense of honor, to a life of courage, and a commitment to something greater than themselves. They have always defended this nation and each other. They still do. The few, the proud, the Marines.
Hybrids. Why are hybrids always tiny cars? They never have seating for 8, a DVD entertainment system, an 8-inch nav screen, and all the trimmings. You know what they should hybrid? This thing. That's what they should hybrid. Oh, did I just spoil the secret?
What is this?
This is a plan to help take the company green.
Green? You mean like light bulbs, recycling?
These guys have covered everything. Data centers, PCs, networking, supply chains, top to bottom.
Cute. But where is the business value in tree hugging?
They could cut our energy costs by as much as 40%.
40%?
40%.
They're the world's most fascinating super mega celebs, and they're getting uncomfortably personal with Jimmy Kimmel.
You pee in the pool, true?
Everybody does.
Jimmy Kimmel's Big Night of Stars, Sunday at 7, 6 Central, followed by the Primetime Emmys on ABC.
You're watching ESPN College Football on ABC, presented by Best Buy.
And we're back in College Station, 24-10 our score, with 11 and a half minutes left in the third quarter. And we'll show you some video from last night. Longtime friend and a very special friend, R.C. Slocum, former head coach here at Texas A&M University, a Hall of Fame inductee last night. You can see that medal that he's wearing around his neck. And as soon as we run this first play, R.C. has moved into the booth here with us, and we're going to get a visit with him about last night and also about the current head coach here at Texas A&M, who just happened to be on his very first staff here in College Station. Miami from their own 14-yard line. Straight ahead, and they're not going to have any gain on this one. R.C. Slocum, welcome and congratulations. I can't really imagine, just that had to be terribly special last night to have all your peers and friends there to say, hey, job well done. We want you in our Hall of Fame.
Well, it really was. I told them a representation of many outstanding coaches. Mike Sherman had a part of that. great players, too numerous to name, over a 30-year career, that is really recognition for all of them as much as it was for me.
Tell me, well, as we do this play right here, we're going to have a sweep and, well, broken for big enough yardage for a first down. And again, they've got Cooper into the fray. How did you and Mike Sherman, had you been friends for a long time before you invited him on your staff, or how did all that come about?
I'd met Mike Sherman at one time. He was on the staff at Tulane with Bob Davey, and I'd met him back then. And then he was at Holy Cross with Mark Duffman. And it was really, they were doing a great job on offense. So I was aware of him, and I'll never forget the convention was in Nashville that year, and I interviewed him there. I was very impressed with him, ended up hiring him.
Run one more play right here, and we'll get you some more questions. Ed, I know, has something he wants to talk to you about. Those Cooper youngsters really tough. Ed?
Coach, Wrecking Crew and that name and what that means to this university, gone for a little while trying to bring some of that tradition back. What's it mean for this community? Been around it for so long. To have a guy like Mike Sherman, who really kind of came up as a coach here, to have a guy like that back for this community.
Well, I think it's important. He knows his school. He understands the culture of Texas A&M. This is a special place. I think he appreciates that. And I think he'll do a great job of bringing back some of those things that we all take a lot of pride in. He's got to get some more speed on this defense. And,
yes.
I think that'll be the first step that we can take. Now, they're playing better, though. I'll say this. The drive right before the half was that hurt in this game. But we've still got a lot of football left.
RC, you mentioned the fact that some of the places that Mike had coached, one of those things you mentioned, Holy Cross, that's more in the neck of woods of where he grew up. Did you worry about that? Was not an East Texas accent he was talking to your boys in.
No, you know what I did? I put him in Southeast Texas to recruit in Louisiana. They thought he was from Louisiana. You know, they thought he was a Cajun or something. You know? So he fit right in down there. But he did a great job. He's one of the best recruiters I had and one of the hardest working coaches I had the whole time.
Marv gets the pass complete, and this is going to be a big gainer across midfield, and it is Epps who finally will be pushed out at around the 31-yard line.
You're talking about the speed, and of course Miami, you remember back when you were coaching late 80s, early 90s, how much speed they have. How impressed are you looking at Miami and what the other sideline Randy Shannon's trying to do?
Well, I saw them against Florida. I watched that game, and I could tell they were on their way back. They're really impressive closing on defense. They've got tremendous speed there, and they've got, obviously, a great tradition. I've known Bill Young for years, and he's an excellent football coach, too. I saw him coach here last year at the University of Kansas here and did a great job coaching their defense.
This is going to be a first down play as they're scrimmaging just outside the A&M 30, and this pass is going to be well overthrown. If you will, before we let you go, another line or two on Randy Sanders, because more coaches now are getting away from trying to be head coach and coordinators, and he's given it to Bill Young. He said, it's his. I'm only the special teams coach now. A, the wisdom in that, and B, the fact that I see more discipline on the Miami sideline than I've seen in a while, and I think all of these things add up to a total positive thing.
I think it's positive, and there are guys that do it different ways. I've always felt that somebody has to be managing this football game for Miami and for A&M. And if you're involved on a down-to-down deal where you're calling plays or calling defenses, you're probably missing a whole lot of other things going on. And you need to have people that you delegate. The jobs for the head coaches are too big to be doing it all. Yeah, that's why you hire assistants. And you sit back and manage and say, okay, now our offense is in control here. You know, let's just play sound on defense. Or you say, you know what, we can't slow these guys down. We're going to have to blitz, do something to, you know, to change things. So I think someone removed from the down-to-down deal who is watching how this whole game is evolving, being able to go to the bench over and talk to players and see the look in their eyes and talk to them, that's what a head coach should be doing.
It's going to be a first and goal here. That was Collier on that receiving end. And that's going to be short gain inside the five. Ed, quickly, one more question you've got for RC.
Why is Mike Sherman, in your opinion, the right guy for this job here at Texas A&M?
I think Mike Sherman understands A&M. He knows the culture here. This is a special place and a unique place. And I think he understands all of that. I think he'll recruit to it. He'll have his players play into it. And I think he'll do a great job. I've got a lot of confidence in the future of this program.
One more play and... Gonna let you go here. Miami knocking on the door. 24-10, and this running play is going to be stopped short of the goal line. RC, thank you so very much. And I'm not so proud that I won't invite myself to go fishing because I'm going to ask you that right
good,
now.
Good deal.
I'll come work the grill.
Good deal. Good to see you guys.
Hey, thanks. Congratulations. Congratulations.
Thank you very much.
Great career and well deserved to go into the Hall of Fame. RC Slocum, our special guest. And our situation on the field is a third down and goal for the Miami Hurricanes. Aggie crowd trying to get him up. Throws back over the middle, has a man, and he overthrew Khalil Jones. And it's going to be a fourth down situation for the Canes.
Well, R.C. Slocum, who was Mike Sherman's boss here at A&M, of course, the winningest coach in A&M history. You don't have a Hall of Fame if he's not in it for the Aggies. But you could see he's still got the coach in him, talking about what he sees. Speed not quite there yet for A&M defensively. But
he's very smart to put it that way, because there's no sense in trying to put a shine on something for the alumni that's not true. 20-yard field goal attempt, and this kick has got plenty of leg, and it's good. So as we go to break, before the game this afternoon, not only the ceremony last night, but before the crowd, R.C. Slocum honored in front of the Kyle Field audience.
The GM employee discount for everyone. On every 2008 car, truck, and crossover. And now, most 2009s. You pay what we pay. Not a cent more. It's a good time to get a great price. But only until September 30th. The GM employee discount. Find your employee price at GM.com.
I decided to redecorate our living room. What I did, something didn't feel right. And then I figured it out. It wasn't the room.
What?
So I used the cash I got back to redecorate my husband.
With your City Cash Returns card, earn unlimited cash back and get it mailed to you automatically. Whatever your story is, your City Cash Returns card can help you write it. Because City never sleeps.
Our neighbors, they come for a really good time. A really good meal, and a really good deal. Like Applebee's all-you-can-eat feast, starting at just $9.99. Choose from all-you-can-eat riblets, all-you-can-eat shrimp, or all-you-can-eat chicken fingers. Hey, is that all-you-can-eat? All-you-can-eat riblets, shrimp, or chicken fingers, starting at just $9.99. For a limited time only, and only at Applebee's. It's a whole new neighborhood.
Some people go through life following Plan A. It's predictable, expected, but my plan is to do more, to work on my terms, to open up new perspectives, to find a competitive advantage.
Welcome to Plan B from Brother. Our inkjet all-in-ones make your biggest ideas look even bigger. It's the smarter way to work in color.
My plan is to write my success story every single day.
Make the smarter choice. Plan B from Brother.
ESPN College Football on ABC, brought to you by the GM Employee Discount for Everyone, Aflac, Ask About It at Work, and College Game Day is built by the Home Depot. You can do it, we can help.
And it's very obvious where we're looking here outside the stadium, the graveyards of former Reveilles, the mascot of the Texas A&M Fighting Aggies. And this year there is a new Reveille, which we'll talk more about before the game's over.
And a new Ugga at Georgia. Uh-huh. And a new Ralphie at Colorado. Got a bunch of freshmen starting across the country.
I guess you have to bring them along slowly also. Kick off to the 10. This is Gray. Gray, whoa, does he take a shot at the 25-yard line? Matt Weiner, let's check in with you.
All right, Ron, new quarterback for Oregon. Verizon Wireless update. Boise State, the Broncos all over the Ducks today. This is Kellen Moore, who's been picking apart Oregon all afternoon. 73 yards here to Vinny Ferretta. Moore's third touchdown pass of the day. And Boise State, which had never beaten a BCS conference team on the road, is on their way. 34-13.
Matt, thanks very much. I know one of the things that Ed wants to talk about, and I do as well, the head coach at Boise. I think this Chris young Peterson. Man is really going to start getting some mentions if they continue to play this well.
Intercepted by the defender, Moncur, who was right in front of the pass, and Johnson just turned and threw it, and he threw it to the wrong color jersey.
And I wouldn't be surprised if maybe we have a review. It looked like Moncur was battling that ball when it hit the ground, but a bad chop block by the left tackle. Moncur does an excellent job. Yeah, it looked like his hand was under it. I wouldn't be surprised if they took another look, but it was the left tackle Schumard who didn't get enough of him. And you mentioned they weren't sure if Moncur was going to be able to play, but when he is healthy, he had a sports hernia surgery during the offseason. When he is healthy, he's a very athletic guy. Remember the play made against Florida.
Is under review. Mm-hmm.
The play is under review. And Ed, one of the things you might also talk about, but we can go back and even look at it one more time. Normally you chop the defender on the outside so he can't jump up and do what Moncur did just now.
Well, and it's the athleticism of Moncur with Schumard going at his knees to back away and then make the play. He's got it on his hip. I don't think that he ever had possession until, let's see if it, but the ball didn't hit the, well, boy, that's close. And they'll look at it a couple of times, but remember, and had this situation Wisconsin-Fresno State where they overturned a Fresno State fumble. The WAC came back and said there was not indisputable video evidence to overturn the call on the field. I think that might be what we have here. I'm not sure he caught it, but I'm not sure that you have the video evidence. It's impossible to tell if the nose of the ball touched the ground when he rolled forward. So
it's a great athletic effort by huge fella. Sharpton was the man who was applying the pressure on the quarterback, Gerard Johnson.
Yeah, I'm not sure if they can overturn it.
Following review, the ruling on the field stands. First down.
So that is a difficult lesson, but a lesson that'll have to be well learned by the freshman quarterback.
And to know the verbiage they use when they say the play is confirmed, that means that it showed it was that. If it was just that it stays, it means they couldn't really tell. So there they couldn't tell, and I think rightly didn't overturn it.
Cooper in the backfield. Marr throws for the corner of the end zone. Got a man there, and did he have possession? Touchdown, Miami. Farquharson on the receiving end, and the official had help from his side judge, and I think he was waiting to make sure that he was not juggling the ball.
They had a personal foul roughing the passer on Texas A&M, so, well, I can see why they like this young man, Marv. He, when given time, and even when not given time, the pocket was collapsing. He is so tough. It's got to come from his linebacker father. His father played 12 years in the NFL.
Extra point attempt is up, and it is good. So we'll go to break. 6:36 left in the third quarter, and as we go to break, one more look at the touchdown.
Summer and fall, they're not that different. You fire up the same grill, rock the same gear, pump the same tunes, and chill with the same beer. Bud Light Lime. Because seasons change, tastes don't. It's the superior drinkability of Bud Light with a splash of 100% natural lime flavor. One taste and you'll find the summer state of mind anytime. It's in the lime.
Space is infinite, but it's my job to shrink it. I work for an Air and Space Museum, and I take the largest objects in the universe and bring them down in size. So when my doctor said that my going and going could get worse because my prostate was growing, I said, how can we shrink it? He said, Avidart. Avidart is different. because over time, it actually shrinks the prostate. So I go less often. Other medicines, they don't treat the cause because they don't shrink the prostate.
Avodart is for men only. Women should not take or handle Avodart due to risk of a specific birth defect. Tell your doctor if you have liver disease. Rarely sexual side effects, swelling, or tenderness of the breasts can occur. Only your healthcare professional can determine if your symptoms are from an enlarged prostate and not prostate cancer. So have regular exams. Ask your doctor about Avodart today. It's your growing problem. It's our job to shrink it. Avodart.
Live three-night premiere Monday on ABC.
You're watching ESPN College Football on ABC, presented by Best Buy.
So when you're back, college football presented by Best Buy, 34-10, the Miami Hurricanes on top, and still just under half of the third quarter left to play. Here's that 15-yard penalty being stepped off against the Aggies for roughing the passer. So it means Miami will be kicking on their own 45. Gray and Stevens, the two deep men for A&M. Bosher will kick it off. Spinner going to come down 2 yards deep and will not be returned. Well, the drama, the romance, it's the season premiere you've been waiting for. Grey's Anatomy. It returns for a 2.5-hour television event. That's on Thursday at 9 o'clock, 8 Central on ABC.
I have a feeling Mike Sherman and his staff will not be watching Grey's Anatomy.
You don't
I think
so?
They're going to be spending some time in the office trying to figure out how to use this young talent, including Cyrus Gray's Anatomy. Sorry.
Keandre Smith also in the lineup, along with number 32, Cyrus Gray. Draw play. Well, you can hear the pads now, and one of the things that is coming back to me as far as remembering the guys with the big U on the side of their headgear is gang tackling, getting to the ball in a hurry, and a lot of hitting.
Let's not forget what happened at the end of last season. They lost their last four ball games. The Orange Bowl, which they were moving out of, they get blown out 48-0 last game of the season with all of the legends there that could be there. Think of the growth in this program from the end of last season to what you see today. It's almost staggering how much better they are today than they were a year ago.
Blitz coming off the corner. Johnson lost the ball, picked up, and touchdown Miami. Glenn Cook, the middle linebacker. And the hit was made by Colin McCarthy, number 44, a junior out of Clearwater. But Cook, who's out of Hollywood, Florida, scores the touchdown.
Feel bad for the Aggies. Feel good for Glenn Cook, a sixth-year senior, was granted an extra year, had 2 years taken away from him. He missed his freshman year with a shoulder injury. He missed almost all of last year with torn ligaments in his big toe. Got the sixth year. They call him Grandpa around the Miami locker room. Nice to see him getting a big play.
So the extra point is good, and let's go back and look at it. McCarthy with the hit, and Glenn Cook will pick it up and score the touchdown of Miami.
Sunday, September 28th. It's the juiciest 5 years in the making season premiere.
I have a husband now.
Who's?
ABC's Desperate Housewives, the season premiere Sunday, September 28th on ABC.
They like to experiment.
You're taking out all his blood?
They like to have a little fun.
You want a spanking?
On Thursday, 9, 8 Central, they're back. Grey's Anatomy returns with a two-hour season premiere event.
You are here to do what I say.
Get out of my patient's room.
Watch out!
ABC's Grey's Anatomy two-hour season premiere, Thursday, 9, 8 Central, part of National Stay-at-Home Week on ABC.
So Miami, after a couple of miscues, they take advantage of them. And it is a 31-point lead, 31-10.
And it's easy, I think, if you're an Aggie fan, to be disheartened with that statistic. But let's not forget what Mike Sherman and his staff are up against, replacing almost all of their offensive linemen, all of their tight ends, and they're starting a sophomore quarterback who keeps making mistakes with the ball. He's got to learn to put that thing away.
This is Gray. Got by one tackler, and finally is going to be stopped just shy of the 30. Matt Weiner, let's check in with you.
All right, Ron, Alabama running back Glenn Coffey is our nominee for the AT&T ESPN All-America Player of the Week, as Coffey was percolating against Arkansas. 10 carries, 162 yards, and a pair of touchdowns, including this 87-yarder as the Tide ran roughshod over Arkansas. Text VOTE to 51234 on your AT&T wireless telephone and cast your vote.
Okay, Matt, our situation here, just had the penalty against Miami. And they're going to move the ball. Well, let's see. The officials are going to place it down at around the 42-yard line. Mike Sherman pacing the near sideline. His ball club at the 5:36 mark of the third quarter, down 41-10. Let's take one more look at that play that caused that last touchdown.
Well, we've seen Drew Johnson a couple of times. He's got to be able to, you just got to tuck that ball. An excellent job by Colin McCarthy coming on the blitz. He just, Sherman, been around the block a bunch. Had a quarterback in Green Bay, Brett Favre, who liked to take a bunch of chances, and you just have to be more careful with the ball. And with a senior quarterback, Stephen McGee, on the sideline, those are the problems you're going to have.
Now the ball comes under a heading of discipline. There are different kinds of discipline, but that's one of them, as he stands in the pocket this time and throws the ball very, very nicely, complete to Pierre Brown.
And he'll get it. Gerard Johnson, if there was one thing that impressed me yesterday, highly intelligent guy. He gets a sense of what's going on. His dad was a high school coach, played at A&M. He knows this game. He'll figure it out. And Stephen McGee, with the shoulder sprain, over there cheering on Johnson, because I'm sure deep down he knows when I'm gone, this young man's going to do a fine job at the quarterback position.
Well, there's no sense in putting Stephen into a situation where you not only could end his season, but end his career. Down the sideline, that's going to come back because of holding. Going to be taken by Goodson all the way to the 3. But you'll see a block right on the sideline. What paved the way is it was a lockup block. And I mean, it looked like a Texas two-step as they were coming down the sideline together. So 41 yards in the play, but it'll come back.
Holding. Offense number 2. 10 yards from the spot of the foul. Remains first down.
That's E.J. Shankle. Another guy who has been on and off the 2 and 3 deep, getting some action, and just did not let go, working one-on-one with JoJo Nicholas over there on that sideline. Of course, you run right by the officials. They usually see that.
Yeah. And they were not merciful in this case. So erase the 41-yard run, and a scrimmage, though, from their own 40-yard line. Johnson gonna keep it. Runs out of bounds at around the 42-yard line. Alan Bailey was there to put pressure on him, along with Colin McCarthy, number 44.
And you start to see some of the speed that brought Bill Young from Kansas down to Miami. So we're in this part of the press box. We can't see through the sunscreens they have up there. But Bill Young has such an impressive resume. Ohio State, Oklahoma, USC. did an amazing job at Kansas. I know all those other schools have the brand names, but what he was able to do with that defense at Kansas was exactly why Randy Shannon brought him down here.
So a timeout is called by Texas A&M. We'll hold it right here with 3:41 to play. And let's check in on the sideline again with Jack Aroot. Jack?
Yeah, it's been fun to watch the ebb and tide on the Miami bench. You know, they're ahead, and all of a sudden, Patrick Nix and that guy Randy Shannon, when they talked to them before the start of the game, I think they had a lot of questions that they weren't sure had been answered yet. And then Patrick Nix, just when the defense scored, he was sitting off by himself, and he got excited. It became infectious. Randy Shannon got excited. The crowd and the players got excited. And then it took both Randy and Patrick Nix to go down to every player and say, hey, don't lose your focus. Stay focused. We're still not the W in this game. So I think they know they've got a lot at stake as they get ready to kick off ACC play and bringing back a W to Miami this weekend.
And one of the things that Randy Shannon's staff worked on during the bye week was all these young players, what they noticed against Florida, they played great for 2.5 quarters, but their tank was empty. And so they had to work with these guys, Spence and these young linebackers, and they had to work on, okay, you got to go hard, but you also have to know all that emotion and all that energy expended too early, and you can't play 4 quarters. That's what they're trying to get to as a 4-quarter team.
Johnson's pass. Got it right there, and that's complete to McCoy. And it's Terrence McCoy. Time now for the ESPN New All-State Standing Review.
Well, it's amazing when you look at the top 10. After the Pac-10 is represented by USC, you go Big 12, SEC, SEC, Big 12, SEC, Big 12, your Big 10 team, and then SEC and SEC. I think it's kind of obvious the two conferences that most likely are going to put somebody in the national championship game this year.
First and 10, Texas A&M. It's time for the Miami 29. Johnson, the flag comes down, is on the block. There was a tackle. That's Goodson, and this will go all for naught as he is tackled at around the 19. I think that was Schumard on Ojomo, was it?
Offense number 76. 10 yards from the previous spot. Remains first down.
Well, it was such a great move at the line of scrimmage that Schumard really didn't have a choice.
What a, you know, it's interesting that Schumard and Ojomo, it does sound like a Mediterranean law firm or something akin, and they were together on that play.
It was a dance school.
Yes.
Well, as Dan Fouts used to tell his offensive linemen, I can come back from a 10-yard penalty. I can't come back from a dislocated shoulder. If you need to tackle someone, you tackle them.
Keandra Smith is in the ball game at tailback for Texas A&M, number 26. And he's in blocking Johnson. Pass is tipped. And now here comes a flag and a second flag. Chavis Grant got a hand on it.
That looked clean to me, Grant. I wonder if they're going to get Nicholas for trying to take a hit at a defenseless player, which is a
pass interference on the defense, number 24, 15 yards, automatic first down.
That looked pretty great, clean to me. Let's see if the left hand of Grant. It looked clean from up here, and it looked very clean there. I'm not quite sure how you get a pass interference on that one. That was played as well as you can play it by Grant.
So with his first down and the new line of scrimmage is the 24. Clock shows 2:36 left in the third quarter. Johnson gonna run it, looking for his safety valve, Goodson, and the flag comes down, and we're gonna have a late hit on the quarterback here or what? It was Dwayne Hendricks continued to run after the quarterback, Gerard Johnson.
There is no foul for an eligible receiver on the field. Second down.
Well, here's a reminder coming up later. We'll be naming the Chevrolet MVPs of our game.
Now for A&M. We're still sitting here in third quarter. You're down 31. So if you want to get back in, you've probably got to start thinking about now from here forward, speeding it up a little bit. And they had trouble at the end of the half running the hurry up. So not sure they're quite comfortable in that offense.
I think go with a tight eye formation set here. Quick pass. It was complete to McCoy. And Terrence out of Midland Lee. He and his brother Jamie is a junior. Jamie is a tight end, was a wide receiver. Terrence a little bit larger, 6'4", and he only weighs 198, where his brother, who's shorter, weighs 224.
Jamie moved to tight end just this year, and the coaching staff very pleased with Terrence's brother. And they said he's ahead of where they thought he would be at this point. So both of the McCoys are going to be weapons for the next couple of years for Mike Sherman and his staff.
About to go under 2 minutes left, third quarter. Low pass for Johnson, got it away, throws complete at the 5. Touchdown, Fuller. Jet Fuller, freshman right out of high school. This time last year was playing for McKinney Boyd High School.
And he is a junior, of course. Jeff Fuller, senior. Great Aggie defensive back, played some linebacker, has 2 Super Bowl rings with the 49ers. And that was a nice throw by Gerard Johnson under pressure.
He got tagged just as he delivered it.
It was a meet at the quarterback by white jerseys. And they're very excited about Fuller. He comes out of his break very fast and did a nice job getting into the end zone.
So here's a replay as Bean knocks home the extra point.
Bad snap by Matthews. He's late picking up the blitz. Johnson gets a face full of white jerseys. And Fuller, we've been talking about all the true freshmen for Miami. This guy looks the part. He's a big player, 6'4", 209 pounds. And it was interesting, Ron, when we were talking to Mike Sherman about the change in college football since he was last here in 96, and he mentioned the passing leagues, the 7-on-7 leagues that the state of Texas has.
Yeah. And plus, in fact, quarterbacks then were option quarterbacks.
Oh, yeah.
You know, wishbone, any kind of option you could invent, you could devise, and it would work, and that's what they were. But not anymore, not in this state.
And back when Mike Sherman was first here, I'm not sure that Jeff Fuller Jr., whose dad played defensive back, wouldn't have been a defensive player, because that's what Mike Sherman said. Texas high school football, it was all about defense and the option. So a guy like Jeff Fuller Jr. at 6'4", 209 pounds, probably would have played safety, not receiver.
Well, we're under a cloud right now. Things cooling off just a little bit here at the stadium. One thing that has not cooled off is the play of the Miami Hurricanes, though. And even with a minute 55 left to play in the third, they own a 41-17 lead. That's a good kickoff. Going to hit on the very end line. Well, tonight on ABC, number 3 Georgia is going to take on Arizona State. This ball game's out in Tempe. Saturday night football presented by Southwest Airlines at ABC tonight, 8 o'clock.
Well, being a Pac-10 guy, the luster was taken off of this game a little bit when Arizona State lost to UNLV. The Pac-10 went 0-4 last weekend against the Mountain West Conference. And now with East Carolina losing today, now the conversation has to start switching out west. The guys at Boise State out of the WAC, TCU, BYU, those teams out of the Mountain West of who might get into the BCS bowl game this year from out of the Big Six.
Quick pass. And Collier, that's interesting. He almost stopped for a moment. Everybody did around him as well. Well, speaking of stopping, let's go down to the sideline. Here's Jackaroo. Jack?
Guys, I need your help.
Yes.
Right? Help me understand this. Here's what's happened. Patrick Nix, Robert Barber's out back throwing catch. Patrick went up to him, and they started an animated conversation. Because he was outside the box, I listened in. He said, hey, get ready in the next series. We're going to go and take some big shots. Let's see what that means.
Well, what it means is we want to work on the big shot part of the offense. Flags come down. Play is knocked down for a 3-yard loss. Garrick Williams out of DeSoto, Texas, making the stop.
And that's been really the puzzle for Patrick Nix and the offensive staff for Miami. Back it up. Is figuring out what the quarterback can do in complement to what the receivers can do, because
holding. Offense number 84. That penalty's declined. Brings up third down.
Okay, so my quarterback can throw the slant really well. Well, if I don't have a receiver that's comfortable running, I can't call it. And that's really what they've been trying to do, is match a bunch of youngsters with young quarterbacks.
Well, game conditions, the only way you're going to learn it. And some people might think it's running it up. I think it comes under teaching. As long as you don't go, you know, too far. They're sitting at 41 right now. Maybe a couple of times after that, put it in the bus. Barb is sacked, and that is Gerard Eddy. Tony Gerard Eddy, a redshirt freshman, also out of DeSoto, Texas. A nice punt all the way back to the 38. This is Pugh gets turned to flip. I'll tell you, McCarthy, not only on special teams but playing as a backup linebacker, we've called his name a lot today. He has he's been very active.
He had that big block on that punt return.
That's right.
That, even though it was an A&M player that got hit, it even wowed this crowd. And a few plays ago did a great job chasing down a screen.
So Gerard Johnson has gone the distance today, if you were with us and then have come back to see what the score is. Quick pass. That's Goodson, and Goodson will be tackled at around the 42. And I'm going to be shocked if we see Stephen McGee because of that injury to his shoulder. As the third quarter runs out, Miami scored 24 unanswered points in the third quarter to take this commanding lead. This presentation of college football presented by Best Buy will continue after this message and a word from our ABC stations. Just as we come back, you can see that quick out pass and a nice defensive play by the defender. McCoy caught it, and Bruce Johnson was all over him. He did not pick up the first down, according to where we're looking from here.
Well, if you're Miami, you better be ready for a play fake. And Johnson talking about, Jack was talking about Patrick Nix wanting to take a shot. Wouldn't be too surprised if Nolan Cromwell, the offensive coordinator for A&M, dials one up here as well.
Seemed like in the first half, Nolan and his offensive guys were able to confuse Miami, mixing the plays up a little bit more. But I guess when you get down by this margin as they pick up the first down, a little bit harder to do that sort of thing.
They've got a long way to go. And R.C. Slocum, of course, the all-time winning coach here at A&M in the booth, just put into the Hall of Fame here at Texas A&M, and he immediately talked about speed on defense. Of course, that's where it's always kind of started here at A&M with the Wrecking Crew. But there is a lot of recruiting to do on the offensive front, receiver, tight end. They're going to have to build some depth in this program here going forward.
It's actually the way it should start everywhere with defense. Boy, Jaworski Lane, did you hear that pickup block? Sounded like an explosion, and the ball is thrown complete at the 28-yard line. I don't know if we can get that again, but I mean, Jaworski Lane stayed there to help out his quarterback, and you could hear bam.
And Lane, who was...
Listen to this.
Going toe-to-toe with Darryl Sharpton.
I'll tell you.
Sharpton didn't give up, but that's a big man, almost 300 pounds, in Lane, who was moved full-time to fullback by the new staff.
About 275 against 235. That's a pretty good matchup of sizes, huh? 500 pounds. Johnson wants to run. Well, and a check in again with Jackaroo. Jack?
Yeah, guys, you were talking about Jaworski Lane. Remember, he was all everything at tailback, and then they moved him to fullback, and he did it reluctantly. They said, look, we got a target weight. We want to see you get down about 265. Well, he was well on the way. It dropped about 15 pounds, and then he had a neck stinger, a neck problem that caused severe headaches. Next thing you know, he balloons back and loses all the weight that he had lost. He's back up to about one hamburger shy of 300. But boy, when you heard that hit, I think I'd get him about four more Big Macs and just keep it pulled up.
Third down, and they need to take it to the 24. Johnson gets it out. They're going to have the first down easily. Jamie McCoy here.
And kind of frustrating for the coaching staff and for Jaworski Lane, because he was headed for that target weight. He is such a gifted athlete for a big man. He's got great hands, great feet. He really projects well to the next level as a fullback, but he does struggle with his weight. When he had that neck stinger and those headaches, he couldn't physically do anything. He couldn't even work out, and so the weight went back on because he wasn't able to participate in anything.
Swing pass, DeAndre Smith breaks the tackle at the 10 and then goes down to around the 7-yard line. But folks, let me tell you something. They're right here on this side of the field, and we're almost a third into the fourth quarter. They are still really whacking away at each other. There are some hits being delivered down on that field.
Yeah, that was Dwayne Hendricks. One of the things we noticed on film with Miami's defense is how well their interior linemen pursue the ball when it's thrown to the outside. And
so there's a timeout. Let's go to break. 41-17, the Miami Hurricanes. We'll be right back.
You're watching ESPN College Football on ABC, presented by Best Buy.
A work of art, a finely tuned machine, a sanctuary, a command center, a sophisticated sedan, a sports car. Together. Introducing the all-new Nissan Maxima, the four-door sports car. Lease a new 2009 Nissan Maxima for $339 a month for 39 months.
You deserve a meal made for men. Introducing Taco Bell's Big Box Meal. A Crunchwrap Supreme, Burrito Supreme, Cinnamon Twist, a large drink, and featuring the new Volcano Taco. Eat like a man.
I'm poolside with John Graham, MVP of the Graham Honeymoon. John, what was the key for you this week?
Wow, I just really wanted to come out here and play my game, you know? Get the latest info on my fantasy players, then set my roster for total domination.
Can you describe your emotions?
Excited, proud, stuffed. That buffet's pretty robust.
Okay, back to you guys in the studio.
Be an ESPN MVP. Manage your fantasy teams, get live game casts, exclusive commentary, and more with VCast, only from America's most entertaining network, Verizon Wireless.
Hotels.com gave me 50% off my vacation. But that's through Hotels.com. It doesn't guarantee you a good review.
Get up to 50% off your next vacation. Welcome to Hotels.com.
Sometimes just getting to retirement seems impossible. That's where we come in. As one of the nation's 401k leaders, the Principal offers many simple ways to plan for retirement, making it easier for you to get where you're going. The Principal Financial Group will give you an edge.
This Tuesday, ABC brings the season's biggest new show right to your door. You just need to know everything about your family.
How much do you think your husband weighs?
ABC's Opportunity Knocks premieres Tuesday, 8, 7 Central on ABC.
Well, with A&M knocking on the door, Randy Shannon, if you can read his lips, says this is not over. And it's exactly what we were talking about earlier, Jack Arut talking about Knicks. And all the coaches telling these young players, it's not over. They're dealing with that youth and they start to feel like, oh, this is over. Well, you know, you've got 11:37 to go, a lot of ball to be played.
Second down, and the play will go down to the four. It was Dixon making the tackle on Keandre Smith.
And this is teaching time, really, for both of these teams. So it's like Stephen Wesley coming off.
Yeah. Thing. Yep. Second time, in fact, I think that he has had to hobble off. Aggies will scrimmage from the 4-yard line, first and goal. Lane leads the way with a block, and Miami fills the hole nicely. It'll be a gain of maybe one, and Alan Bailey is there to make the tackle for Miami.
That's rough sledding against that front four right now. I think you got to move the pocket, do a little boot, maybe a naked boot with Gerard Johnson. So fake a handoff to the right, have him come out to his left, have a couple receivers, one posted in the back of the end zone, one mid, one right up in front, and he's got three guys to look at and maybe run it.
Well, keep an eye on Jaworski Lane again. Mike Goodson is the tailback, and probably where Jaworski goes, that's where number three is going to go. Nope, they counter it. Goodson moved to the outside. Cuts it back, and he'll be tackled at the 2-yard line. Wow, that is great quickness by Dwayne Hendricks.
Well, that's the second time we have seen Hendricks with great pursuit. Goodson walks in. If Hendricks, a 300-pounder.
I started to say, he's 6'4", 300, and moves just cat-quick. For everybody that's got Miami on their schedule in coming years, I got a message for you. I wouldn't want to play them later this year. I wouldn't want to play them now, maybe.
I think you have to start mentioning them in the Coastal Division
of
the ACC.
I'm telling you. I guarantee you there's some coaches over there that might have seen a little bit of this today that are feeling the same way. There's a timeout on the field. Miami 41-17. Just under 10 to play. We'll be right back.
You know, scientific tests have proven that when you drink Dr. Pepper slowly, the 23 flavors taste even better. Hey, I get it, because half my life's been in slow motion. Watch this.
Okay, here we go. High ball game.
Inbound to the doctor. He puts them at 30. Slower is better.
Are you kidding me?
Trust me. I'm a doctor.
That's a fitted Dr. J right here.
Introducing the all-new Nissan Maxima. It has an award-winning 290 horsepower V6 engine, an intelligent CVT transmission, and a masterfully crafted interior designed around the driver. The breathtaking Nissan Maxima, the four-door sports car. Lease a new 2009 Nissan Maxima for $339 a month for 39 months.
It's time saving energy costs less. It's time guaranteed low prices got even lower. We know times are tough. That's why the Home Depot is lowering the cost on hundreds of items throughout the store, including energy-efficient ones like ceiling fans and programmable thermostats. So the products that save you the most money will save you even more. The Home Depot. You can do it. We can help.
ESPN College Football on ABC, brought to you by Best Buy, you happier. Nissan, passionate about performance and proud sponsor of the Heisman Trophy. And Allstate, proud sponsors of college football. Are you in good hands?
Welcome back. 9:37 left in our ball game. 41-17 Miami. Here's my question. Is Jaworski out there? Yep. He's a blocker lined up wide on the left. He is tied to the all-time touchdown lead of Texas A&M as the ball is thrown complete the other direction for the touchdown to Mike Gibson. We were just wondering the way he had been blocking today if they might give him a shot at number 45.
We saw them in practice doing their end zone run scheme, and Lane had been given the ball a couple of times, but they decided to go with the speed of Goodson. Ball was actually tipped there by Bailey, and good concentration by Goodson to be able to bring it in, and barely, I mean barely, got across the line from Mike Sherman.
So they will go for two, trying to make it a 41-25 ball game.
And the reason you go, they're going to review this. The reason you go for two here is you get it to two touchdowns, two-point conversions to tie instead of 17, which is two touchdowns and a field goal. Although two-point conversions, about 40%, so you'd have to get it twice. That'd be pretty difficult. Yeah, I think that's a touchdown. Let's see. Are they talking about whether he had possession or whether that was a touchdown? He was down. Again, Ron, I think it's one of those ones where there's not enough evidence to overturn it, so they'll just have to leave it as called on the field.
He's got possession right there. They're on his feet or
look to me like
the, the end zone line.
Yeah, and the ball was over those feet, so that would lead me to believe that he was in for the touchdown.
Well, we'll wait and see.
This is one of those weird numbers on the coach's chart of when to go for two.
Yeah.
It's kind of a choice. Me, I 17, I think, just because two-point conversions are so hard to get. They're right at about 40% success rate. Now, you put yourself, I don't mind the fight. Just not sure how realistic that is, but never give up.
Here we go.
After review, the ruling on the field stands. Touchdown.
So the touchdown stands. Nine. They will go for two. Johnson back over the middle, and the ball is thrown right into coverage, and the defensive play is made by Bruce Johnson. So the two-point conversion fails, and it's 41-23. Take a timeout. 9:32 left in our ball game.
You're watching ESPN College Football on ABC, presented by Best Buy.
Nissan set out to create the perfect on-road vehicle, and in the process, created a category. Introducing two crossover leaders from Nissan. The redesigned Murano, awarded as an IIHS top safety pick. And the versatile Rogue, named 2008's best new small crossover. Lease the 27 MPG Nissan Rogue, just $229 a month. Don't follow the leader, own one. At your Nissan dealer now.
No, maybe you should have been the blonde.
Maybe you should just listen to the game.
Maybe if you shaved your legs like me, the sneak-in would have worked.
Maybe if you hadn't lost our season tickets in a lawsuit because you got cheapo insurance, we'd be inside the stadium, watching the game, dressed like men. Huh?
I don't want to get into this she said thing.
Getting cut-rate insurance to save a little money could end up costing a lot. Call an Allstate agent today for a free Good Hands coverage checkup. Are you in good hands?
Dancing with the Stars, live three-night premiere, Monday on ABC.
From the network that changes lives on Extreme Makeover Home Edition comes a new series that celebrates the families who stay together and play together.
The game is on!
Tuesday, ABC brings the season's biggest new show right to your door. All you need to know is everything about your family.
What is the name of the girl your brother has a crush on?
ABC's Opportunity Knocks premieres Tuesday at 8, 7 Central, part of National Stay at Home Week on ABC.
At halftime here at Kyle Field, this is the Prairie View A&M Marching Band. They are here representing Miami because it is such a long and expensive trip. So they were invited to come and perform and also be the pep band for Miami. They did. And let me tell you, all the people at Prairie View A&M, you did not get to see this. These kids, not only did you proud, man, they put on one heck of a show. And in fact, this capacity crowd came jumping to their feet and gave them a standing ovation. As we have an onside kick and a ball is loose at the 30, let's call it the 41-yard line, and it has been recovered by Miami. Matt Weiner, let's check into New York with you.
All right, Ron, a lot of cheering at Wrigley Field this afternoon. Sports Center right now, powered by Vizio, and the Cubs beat the Cardinals 5-4 to clinch the NL Central title for the second straight season. They're the first National League team to secure a playoff spot. The Angels are in the American League, and the Rays currently lead the Twins. If they wrap up that victory, they will also be playoff bound for the first time in franchise history.
Thank you, sir. 9:32 left in our ball game. Because of the missed onside kick, Miami with excellent field position. And Cooper gets the handoff, runs into his own man, but he's still going to take it for a gain of almost 8 yards on the play. You know, just one other thing on the Prairie View kids, and I'll let you talk some more football here. They were excited about being able to perform in front of a crowd this big here. And I'll tell you, they brought their A game now. They were fun to watch. And it was fun to watch the crowd react and how they stood and gave them a standing ovation at the end. And the kids felt really good about themselves.
It's neat that Miami asked them to come and represent them, because Prairie View A&M, the fans here maybe would have never seen how good that band really is if not for Miami asking them to come represent them.
Second down and short, and I'll tell you, the hitting continues to go on big time. Let's take a look at the Coastal Division of the ACC.
And you have to start, Miami now has to be in the conversation. They were not in the conversation, picked middle or lower part of the pack to begin the season. Of course, Butch Davis playing against Virginia Tech today, and I think Butch Davis has done a masterful job.
I do too. Virginia Tech has just come from behind. They're up by three late in that ball game.
And I think these Hurricanes, second year Randy Shannon, 5-7 last year, lost their last four ball games. Erase that. That is not what this team is. This team, I think, competes for the ACC Coastal title and goes to face the winner of the Atlantic Division.
Now, this is the quarterback, Marv, who got a direct snap and just took it off tackle, and he's going to have the first down. Randy Shannon, let's show you a timeline. If you do not know his background, where he's been, as I said, he played at the University of Miami. Linebacker, 84 through 88, won a national championship in 87. Assistant coach, national championship, 91. Defensive coordinator, finished in the top 10 at total defense 5 times, and now the head coach. It happened last year, and as Ed said, he finished below 500, but I think you can see a lot of things turning in a hurry. And to me, one of the things that you can see readily, not only an infusion of really good athletes like they used to have, but an also a real infusion of discipline.
And in the classroom.
Yes,
they do. Randy Shannon does not mess around. You go to class. Last year, of the 119 schools in Division 1A, they finished 9th in academic progress rate. That's a nice statistic for this program.
Here's Cooper. Cooper still fighting. That's going to be a gain of 9. Jackaroot, let's check with you.
And you know, guys, I think you got to, as you're saying, give Randy Shannon a lot of credit for what has happened with the Miami Hurricanes since he took over. But I asked Randy before the game, I said, who did you turn to when you were first given the head coach's position? Without missing a beat, he said, I went back to my old coach, Jimmy Johnson. He said, Jimmy told me a lot of the things that I needed to do. And Ed, you and I know that one of the things he told him was, look, and he, You can't be a coordinator as well as be a head coach. He gave that up this year, and he says, now I coach special teams just to keep my head in the game. He said, but I don't even look at the defensive game plan.
Second down and very short. And they give it to Cooper again, and this time he just swallowed up by that middle of the defense.
And you had an interesting conversation a few years ago.
Bo Schembechler. Both came in, and the gentleman who was just a past defensive coordinator here,
Carl Torbush,
and he was the head coach at North Carolina. And so Coach Schembechler stuck his head in the booth. We were doing Michigan at Northwestern, and he just said, you like that guy from North Carolina, don't you? And I said, yeah, I mean, he's a good guy. I think he's a good coach. He said he's going to get fired if he doesn't stop trying to be defensive coordinator and head coach, and went on to explain why you can't do both.
It's too hard. If you're an offensive coordinator, all you have to do is look at a menu. Say, all right, this is going to work, that's not going to work, this is going to work. But when you're a defensive coordinator, you have to watch the other sideline to see, okay, what personnel are they putting in? Then you look down your chart and you say, okay, with two backs and one tight end, we're going to call this. Then you've got to worry about the clock. Did you get the right people in? It's a whole different ballgame. So I agree with Bo Schembechler.
You divorce yourself also, as he said, from a major part of your football team, and it takes you away from being the total team guy.
Yeah.
And that's exactly what RC said a while ago.
The offense isn't getting the head coach's input, and with a guy like Randy Shannon, how disciplined he is, you want him dealing with the offense because that discipline conveys on that side of the ball as well.
So it's again first down, and I mean Cooper. Grant Cooper, the sophomore out of Memphis Melrose High School, continues to put on a show. Gets the ball, spins off the tackle, takes it back into the boundary, and he will be stopped after a gain of one. He ran a very long way just to pick up one. But his first three carries today, folks, went for 77 yards and two touchdowns. That's an average of 25, just over 25 yards a try.
And a lot of people around Miami saying, well, there's an argument of who the best back is at Miami. Well, Javaris James, we mentioned at the top of the show, out with a high ankle sprain. Imagine when he comes back.
And what is better than really good competition?
Yeah.
I mean, you can turn that into a golden situation. Deron Thomas in the ball game. We've got movement.
I think Richard Gordon, the tight end, lined up to the left.
Before the snap, false start. Number 84, offense. 5 yards, remains second down.
And it's interesting, you know, Jack did the report earlier about how Robert Marvin and Ja'Cory Harris, the two young quarterbacks, are friends. Greg Cooper and Javaris James are best buddies. So it's a very healthy competition. Last year there was a few unhealthy competitions in the locker room. Not the case this year at Miami.
Clock runs, about to go under 4 minutes and 30 seconds left in our ball game. Marv, the quarterback. Deron Thomas, the tailback. Marv got a man wide open, and it is intercepted on a great leaping catch by the defender, number one, and that is Mattson.
This is something that Marv is going to have to learn as a young quarterback. He tends to look it in, and Batson did a great job.
First turnover against Miami. Let's take a timeout. 4:19 remaining.
This is my family. This is their new HD TV.
That doesn't look like HD.
I don't think it's hooked up right.
And this is me. Let's see what happens this time when my family goes to Best Buy.
This LG is perfect for you, and Geek Squad can set it up.
I don't know what HD is, but I don't like it.
No interest for 3 years on all LG HD.
Huh? And we are back. Time back in with
to the snap. Offside by contact. Number 93 defense. 5 yards, remaining first down.
4:19 now on the clock. Hendricks offside. Well, that was a nice defensive play to pick off the interception. Baston, senior out of San Antonio, played at Judson High School and Cisco Junior College. pass away, and it's going to be complete out to the 23-yard line. Terrence McCoy.
We've seen Johnson throughout the course of the game get a little better under pressure. This time he knew he was going to get hit. He didn't back away. And not going to see Stephen McGee. This is probably could have played if he had to today, but
I'm not sure he wanted to. But he said to me, ran over toward him, and he was talking with his quarterback coach. And I said, shoulder, you look good. Throw it on the sideline. He said, my shoulder is still very, very sore. And
he takes a, if he took a hit today,
yeah,
that could last the rest of the season. And they've got a long way to go to have their senior quarterback in a non-conference game. All of them are important. Don't want to say they're not, but they're getting ready for league play. You want to have Stephen McGee at 100%. I think another week of rest after a bye week was the right call here.
So the clock now continues to run since we are not under 2 minutes to play in this ball game. It's down to around 3 minutes and 30 seconds left. Nice pitch and catch, and at the 50-yard line, Fuller, the receiver, boy, he is down. Ed Gummett, he has had a really good afternoon, but he got tagged by Reddick. It's good for 21 yards, and I hope that's not a shoulder, but it's like he's trying to protect one side of his body there. Look at the block by Goodson. Excellent protection.
Well, that's got to be a penalty. You know, they've made that a point of emphasis, the leading with the helmet, and I know it's a fast game, but Reddick could not have ducked his head any more and launched himself into the body of Fuller. When there's a question, I think the referee should start throwing the flag. Unless you are absolutely clear that the player led with his shoulder, this is a penalty. In the NFL, Reddick would have a huge fine come Monday. And it's a reactionary play. I don't want to make too much about Reddick, but it's been a point of emphasis this year to throw flags for leading with the helmet, and we're just not seeing it.
No, last night, I sat and watched the game with Baylor. I saw three different occasions where there should have been leading with the head penalties. Only one of them was called. We'll take a timeout. 3:17 left in our ball game.
This is my family. This is their new HD TV.
That doesn't look like HD.
I don't think it's hooked up right.
And this is me. Let's see what happens this time when my family goes to Best Buy.
This LG is perfect for you, and Geek Squad can set it up.
I don't know what HD is, but I don't like it.
No interest for 3 years on all LG HD TVs, $9.99 and up. Best Buy. You happier.
Roderick, quit fooling around and help me build my own Capital One credit card. I'll go with airline miles and a low interest rate. And let's put a picture of Emerald Barkey on it. Oh, he's a salty sea dog, isn't he?
Fine specimen, sir.
Personalize your card at Capital One Card Lab. Choose your rewards, interest rate, even upload your own image at CapitalOne.com.
What's in your wallet?
Nissan set out to create the perfect on-road vehicle, and in the process, created a category. Introducing two crossover leaders from Nissan. The redesigned Murano, awarded as an IIHS top safety pick. And the versatile Rogue, named 2008's best new small crossover. Lease the 27 MPG Nissan Rogue, just $229 a month. Don't follow the leader, own one. At your Nissan dealer now.
Ooh, the never-ending pasta bowl is going on.
Oh, you didn't know?
No, I
figured that's why you were in such a hurry to get here.
No, I had no idea what was going on.
Olive Garden's never-ending pasta bowl is back with delicious new sauces like tomato basil caprese and our Asiago garlic Alfredo. Pick any combination of sauce and pasta, then another. Try them all for just $8.95 plus endless salad and breadsticks.
I'll have the penne with meat sauce followed by the 5 cheese marinara.
No idea, huh?
Olive Garden, when you're here, you're family.
Well, there's a look at Fuller on the sideline, and they did not give him a catch on the play.
And the Fuller family very happy to see Jeff Jr. up, of course. His father Jeff Sr. was paralyzed in a game in 1989 with San Francisco, has since regained most of his movement except for his right arm. So big sigh of relief for the Fuller family, obviously.
Still, they said incomplete pass, and it's third down. They need to take it to the 34-yard line. Johnson lobs it over the middle. Got it complete to Terrence McCoy. McCoy's been quite a presence today. Had a nice ball game. We're about to go under 3 minutes.
And I wouldn't mind seeing A&M. I know the game's out of hand. Try that hurry up offense again. They really looked, it just didn't look smooth at the end of the half. And you're in teaching area right here. Why not give Johnson, who is just a sophomore making his first start, a chance to run that drill? I know you got a lot of things you want to work on, but just see, just let him do that in a game just for teaching purposes, if anything.
Mike Goodson, safety valve right in front of the play. And the ball is thrown way too low. So let's take a look now at the Pacific Life game summary.
Well, it started out all Miami. It started out very balanced and then started going towards all Miami. Greg Cooper, 128 rushing yards. And then Mike Goodson, 146 all-purpose yards. And we're starting to see A&M is going to move him all over the field. If you're a Big 12 team getting ready to play against A&M, you better start planning for number three, because this staff is going to keep using him in many different ways.
A little safety valve on that ball. In trying to maintain possession, the ball was flipped up, and Glenn Cook almost came away with the interception after Keandre Smith couldn't hold on.
And now A&M 0-2 at home, and I know a lot of people, of course, the Arkansas State loss, you lose to a team out of the Sun Belt, although Arkansas State much better than I think people give them credit for. There's going to be some people upset and wondering what's going on, but this staff has a long way to go. A lot of guys graduated, changing an entire program. Third defense in 4 years they're trying to teach these young men. There's a lot to be done.
Flag goes down. That's going to be holding. Johnson. Deep over the middle, and the ball is incomplete. JoJo Nicholas. Samandy tipped it away.
There's our guy.
Fourth down.
There's our guy, Eric Moncur, who we didn't think we were going to play today, who ran, did a great move on Schumard, the left tackle.
By the way, some other peripheral things that happened because of the hurricane. Miami could not stay in Bryan College Station community because of evacuees and people up for the ball game as well. They stayed at the airport in Austin, which is about an hour and 45 minutes away. So anyway, it is, I go back to what we talked about off the top of the telecast, though. If nothing else, but just for a brief moment today, people who've gone through a lot of suffering and heartache over this last week, maybe they got an opportunity to see some of this game today, see some college football, and just get a little time away from the things that have to be really disturbing them. Because, folks, there's no way around it. It's going to take years to clean up the Gulf Coast again. It happened after Carla. It's happened with other hurricanes, and they will rebound. But it's going to be expensive, and it's going to be time-consuming.
You know what hit me in our hotel just down the road? How many evacuees were there? I didn't realize it until I noticed how many people had the dogs with them. Because, of course, they had to evacuate to take their animals with them. And you mentioned, though, a million homes getting power today. So a lot of the evacuees from our hotel able to go home today. It was nice to see those folks heading back to where they need to be, which is in their homes.
Reed Arena. Jack Arruda had a report on this yesterday. And the fact that it was made into a special area for patients that had been moved off the Gulf Coast, who obviously were a little sicker than, you know, that we're not talking about cold and flu and things like that. It was, I assume you would call this a triage unit that they set up over there. And all basketball, you know, went silent there as the pass is thrown incomplete. I saw the head basketball coach last night, and I asked Mark, he said, boy, we're out hard recruiting. And he said, you know, we're working out at the rec center because they're using our arena, Reed Arena, for something much more important right now.
Lee
Grimes. Let's go down the sideline, Jackaroo.
Well, at Reed Arena, in fact, you know, Danny Gore, the cornerback for Texas A&M, his grandfather was one of those special needs patients, so he was evacuated to there. Coach Sherman, some of the team, Danny, they all went over there on Thursday, and he's watching the game today. But in talking to the National Guard and to the people with FEMA, they wanted to give a shout-out for the tremendous effort that the Texas A&M Corps of Cadets actually assisted over there 24/7 since it was set up as a special needs evac center. They said without the help of the cadets guys, they would not have been able to do what they've been able to do. They didn't expect as many oxygen necessary patients as they received, and they just want to give credit to these young men and women that gave their time.
Well, that's what it takes when you have something of such, I mean, this is a huge state, not a big state, it's a huge state, and when you have no idea how much territory we're talking about that just absolutely got demolished. I mean, like a bomb hit it. And is that thing they've always worried so much about a hurricane that would come literally right up the ship channel, which is the open area to the east of Houston. And they were so pleased at what the Corps of Engineers had done on the harbor, and the harbor people themselves, they didn't really lose any time. They only lost a very few days, which means less downtime and not as many people injured.
And in the economy we're in, to be able to get those channels back open is a pretty big deal. Trust me.
Ja'Gory Harris in the ballgame at quarterback for Miami. Chambray McNeil, number 33, a sophomore out of Dallas Madison High School, is a tailback for Miami.
You know, Lee Grimes got hurt on that last play, and I've noticed something that Mike Sherman does every time one of his players is hurt. He goes out and sees how they're doing. You know, a lot of times coaches are so focused on what's next, what's going on in the game. But every time an A&M player has been down on the field, and that's what he's trying to build, is that family atmosphere, this Aggie pride. And every time Mike Sherman has gone out to tend to a player, I applaud that. It's nice to see that, because it makes your players understand you care about them as a human being first and a football player second.
McNeil again. Well, let's take a look now. The Chevrolet MVPs for our ball game, and they are Robert Marv, 15 of 22, 212 yards, two touchdowns and a pick, and Mike Goodson, 146 all-purpose yards and two touchdowns for the Texas Aggies. There's a good look at Mike right there.
We'll get a few more of these this year. You know what's amazing? You think about a guy who's 5'10", putting on 20 pounds, didn't lose a step, and it's almost all in his upper body.
Clock is now under 1 minute. And McNeil is going to be shy of the first down. Randy Sanders and the Miami coaching staff really not too concerned with that right now. They'd like to run it out, don't get anybody else hurt. Get over to Austin, hop on that plane, and fly back to Miami. I don't know, that plane could be flying in here, I guess, though, and they could take the charter back that way instead of having to drive all the way back over.
Miami has to be so happy with what happened with their youngsters on offense. They opened it up, and Patrick Nix has been taking a beating down Miami way, although he shouldn't have been, about being conservative, but you're starting to get a look at what they'll be able to do as these young players get more comfortable in Coach Nix's system.
And a timeout has been called by Miami. 3 seconds on the clock.
30 seconds.
So one final reminder, tonight on ABC, as we told you earlier this afternoon, Georgia, number 3 in the country, at Arizona State, the game in Tempe. And, of course, Saturday Night Football presented by Southwest Airlines at ABC. And tonight it is going to kick off 8 o'clock Eastern Time.
And if you have not had a chance, know Sean Moreno burst onto the scene last year as a freshman. And if you're just getting caught up and trying to find out who the best players are in college football, you could just start right there. He runs so much bigger than he is. We saw him last year in that Sugar Bowl. This guy, whatever it is, he's got a lot of it.
Yeah. But he does have it. Well, this will be take a knee, and this ball game will be over. And that's it. Clock runs 2-1. And now they're holding at one for a second.
Well, because it was fourth down and they fumbled the snap and he was down, and so now
now they
let it go.
We got all zeros. So this one will go into the record books as a win for the Miami Hurricane. And our final score, the Miami Hurricanes 41 and Texas A&M 23. Started off with a hot and heavy barrage of scoring. Two touchdowns in the first 2 minutes and 4 seconds. Then things calmed down, and it was Miami who lurched out in front and stayed there for good. 41-23, Miami wins it. Don't forget, tune in tonight for Saturday Night Football on ABC. Number 3, Georgia at Arizona State. That is at 8 Eastern. So long, everybody, from College Station, Texas.